It's been called the brawl for it all. Some prefer the showdown before sundown. A local paper tabbed this rivalry, the Blue and Gold Super Bowl. Well, for the record, it's the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. Two arch rivals from just down the road clashing in a neutral but hostile Columbus, Georgia. And the stakes couldn't be higher. It's win or go home. The Fort Valley State Wildcats taking the field, led by conference leading rusher Pierre Brown. On the line, the Wildcats looking to end their five-game slide to Albany State and head back to the playoffs for the first time since 2001. But they'll have to get past the Golden Rams from Albany State. The Rams are on a roll, winning the last five showdowns, led by a senior class that's never lost to its heated rival, and they don't intend to start today. Let's give you an idea of where we are. Columbus, Georgia is on the Chattahoochee River, which divides Alabama and the Peach State, about 2 hours south of Atlanta. Fort Valley and Albany are about an hour away, but for 1 week, each fall, these two towns, they merge in Columbus for one big battle royale, take no prisoners, Georgia style. Welcome inside of A.J. McClung Memorial Stadium. Fran Charles alongside Sterling Sharp and Sterling. Both these teams have a 5-1 conference record. Fort Valley State has one more victory with 8. And what really makes Fort Valley State run is the running game that they didn't even discover until early on in the season.
Pierre Brown has an opportunity in this big game to solidify himself not only as the conference leading rusher, but that he is for real. Did an outstanding job running for over 200 yards last week versus Lane College and did it in a very wonderful fashion. Very patient, very powerful, and he finished off a lot of his runs.
Now, we talked to Albany State head coach Mike White earlier in the week, and he said, as our quarterback, Kasan Flakes, goes, so does our offense.
Kasan Flakes is the guy that sets the table, and you would expect this kind of from a running game, but this guy is extremely judicious with the football. Outstanding passing efficiency. He runs the offense the way he plays. Very, very controlled. And what I look for Kasan Flakes to do is to throw the football short early, take a few shots late, but get his football team out of bad plays into a lot better ones.
All right, Fort Valley State, led by head coach DeAndre Clark in his second season, but 13-8 career mark. For three seasons prior, he was a head coach at Shaw University. Mike White in his eighth season as head coach for the Golden Rams. He started the season out calling it the drive for five, trying to win their fifth straight, the Southern Intercollegiate Athletic Conference Championship. That will go to Tuskegee in 2007, but both teams still have an opportunity to get to the playoffs. Fort Valley won the toss, so they deferred, so Albany State will receive here in the first half. And Jake Grubbs will kick off for Fort Valley State. Been deep for Albany State, Ryan Porter and Demetrius Johnson. And it's Johnson at about the 11-yard line, straight up the middle to the 35 for a 24-yard gain. Kasan Flakes, the junior quarterback out of Lovejoy, Georgia, and Flakes. The numbers won't blow you over, but what Mike White said, Sterling, is that this guy does a great job of keeping plays alive, and he has to remind the blockers, stay on your blocks, because Kasan could be coming back around your way.
He is the secondary phase of the offense, and he does a fantastic job of extending the initial play.
All right, so the Golden Rams will get things started at their own 35-yard line, a first and 10, and right away, it's Flakes in the shotgun, and they got three wide receivers to the right, and Flakes keeps it himself, knocked out of bounds at the 43. It's a pickup of 8, and we take a look at the offensive line for Albany State. And Big Tim Johnson, the left guard, is almost 400 pounds. He's listed at 385 and 6'9". He leads the way. Chris Chapman and Montreal Neal, they are also over 300 pounds in the skill set there. Gary Nevins and Demetrius Johnson and Joshua Johnson and Ronnie Childs at the wide receiver set. All right, the second down now for the Golden Rams at their 42. Flakes again in the shotgun, and that's Brian Porter on the option. Porter out over the 45 for the 4-yard gain. And now we take a look at the defense for the Wildcats from Fort Valley State. Narada Williams has 5.5 sacks, so he leads that front four. They play a 4-3. They gotta watch in the middle there. Ivan Diggs, he started out the season as a safety. They brought him in as a linebacker. The coaches say he loves to hit. And what a great second here. Jackson Love, Smith, and Young combining for
14 interceptions.
There we go on a first and 10 now for the Rams at their own 42. They got two backs to the right side. Flakes fakes it to Porter, and he goes up top. But he can't find Nick Kiles.
He couldn't find Nick Kiles because of the pressure by Nerada Williams. He did an outstanding job fighting through some small traffic, and he wouldn't allow Kasan Flakes to step into the throw. Outstanding pressure, jumps inside, got held, and he still made it a very difficult throw. And if you can get this kind of pass rush, you're going to always have an incomplete pass on the back end.
Yeah, Williams leading the Wildcats with 5.5 sacks. They led the SIAC in sacks with 32 so far for the year. It is Porter in the backfield. We've got Flakes again in the shotgun. Two wide receivers to the near side. It's Porter on the handoff and no room to run. Racked up by Sergio Pengel for a loss of 4.
Both of these football teams are extremely patient. They want to be judicious with the football. You're going to see them take some shots like we saw from Kisan in that last play. But they want to control the clock, try and set it up, stay inside of manageable down and distances. This is out of character for Albany right now.
We've got a 4 wide receiver set now. Porter to the right side, Flakes in the shotgun on 3rd and 14. He rolls to the right, looking for Joshua Johnson, but it's incomplete. So on 4th down, the Golden Rams will have to punt.
It's interesting, there's not a lot of pressure Fort Valley talked about. We don't like to bring pressure. We like to sit back and look. Well, the last 2 plays have been pressure. So they've done a good job of getting manageable down and distance situations, putting this Albany State offense, when you get 3rd and long, 2nd and long, they're coming with the pressure. Good job getting off the field on 3rd down.
All right, Randy Allen in the punt now for the Golden Rams. Antoinis cuts deep for Fort Valley State. And Cutts calling for a fair catch. It's a 47-yard punt. Fair catch at the 10-yard line. And
Fort Valley State is led by their quarterback, Garrett Williams, who was a transfer from Division I AA Savannah State. And Sterling, once DeAndre Clark said he had Garrett Williams, he knew he had to get him in the lineup and get him some reps.
Had to get him on the field because this guy just plays the football game exactly like the coach draws it up on the board. It's funny that both of these quarterbacks have more interceptions than touchdowns, but they do a very good job of being efficient trying to throw the football.
So Fort Valley State will start from their own 10-yard line. And they run multiple sets. They start out in high formation. It's Williams on the play action. And he scrambles after he lost his footing. Wardrice McNeil on the chase. It was a pickup of 6 yards for Williams.
I mean, he did an outstanding job of going back. I think because he slipped, he panicked a little bit. But you know what? Looked like he had some receivers open, so I look for them to come back to that play.
All right, let's meet the rest of the offense for Fort Valley State. They got one guy over 300 pounds, the right guard there, a Rodney Culler. Also at the skill positions, Melvin Atui and Nate Randall are the guys to watch. And we talked about Pierre Brown. It comes into this game leading the conference in rushing with 836 yards. Williams now backs up into a shotgun. 2 receivers down to the left side, and it's Detron Dorsey, the fullback. And now we're going to look at Albany State's defense, and they play a 3-4. You got Marshall and Battle on the ends there with Cedric Boone in the middle. DeVal Miller, the linebacker, has 7 sacks, and he's a big fella, 275 pounds. The guy to watch in the secondary, the cornerback, Terry McGee, small in stature, 5'10", 160, but McGee leads the conference in passes broken up with 17. Sterling, I always want to challenge the little guy.
Well, you have to. You have to make sure that he's got it strapped on very tightly every week, and he shows up to play every single play.
All right, trips left here for the Wildcats, but Nathaniel Randall cannot hold on.
Both of these football teams, Fran, are a little jittery coming out of character. You see the quarterbacks carrying the football early in this game. I think they want to settle down a little bit, get that first drive out of their system. So I expect to see a little better offensive play once Albany State gets the football back.
Jake Grubbs does all the kicking for
the Wildcats, punting and kicking. Yeah, he is back to punt and back to receive the punt. Number five, Lamontre Williams. It's a short punt, and it takes a Golden Rams bounce. And so Albany State will start off with great field possession here as the first half of the Mount City Classic is underway.
Valley State.
9:52 left in the first quarter. No score in the Fountain City Classic between Fort Valley State and Albany State. Albany State starting now at the Wildcats 47-yard line, and there is movement. And both teams pointing across the line of scrimmage, Sterling.
Yeah, he did it. No, it was on him. He moved first. That's why the umpire gets to stand right there in the middle and take a look, and he'll have this call correctly.
All right, here's referee Rod Holloway.
We have a dead encroachment, 91 on the defense with contact. 5-yard penalty remains, first down.
Hey, Sergio, you're right over the ball. You really can't go anywhere until the ball moves. So you're trying to get a jump on the snap count there.
The officials joining us from the SIAC. So the Rams picking up 5 yards on that penalty. First and five at the Wildcats 42. And looked like they jumped again. Flakes under pressure over the middle. And it is ruled a catch by Joshua Johnson.
There is no way Keyson Flex is going to finish this football game taking these kind of shots. There's no way possible. I mean, when you look at what Fort Valley's doing to him, he had an open receiver, but because of the pressure, the location of the football was off a little bit, but he's not going to finish this football game. And the location of that football is off a little bit because of so much pressure, but a good job standing in there and getting a completion.
Great job by Johnson to get his hands under the rock. First and 10 now. It's Flakes on the option. He holds on to it, spinning into the secondary. A pickup of 8. Courtney Love on the tackle.
Wow, outstanding run, patience. Did a very good job of staying in the hole, staying with what he wanted to do. And it looks like the offense is definitely going to run through Keyson Flakes. And right now, he is doing a very good job of orchestrating.
Well, and Sterling, this is what Mike White said this team does, which is run the football. They're averaging almost 220 yards a game in the I formation now. Lonnie Davis, the tailback, and he moves the pile down to around the 20-yard line. It's a 4-yard game.
The size of Albany State should take over this football game as we're starting to see a little bit. They are a predominant running football team, just like Fort Valley State. But the size of the interior guys, the two guards, are mammoth. And if you get a chance to run inside behind those guys, I would take every advantage to do so, because little Keyson can hide behind those two mountains of guys right there.
First and 10 for the Golden Rams. His drive started at the Wildcats 47-yard line. They are at the 21, and the I formation is Davis deep. Flakes on the play action. He's hit again. Looking for Kyles, and it's incomplete. Ivan Diggs.
Zero coverage. That means no free safety in the middle. And the reason there's no free safety is Fort Valley's bringing the house. And you get a chance to see that they are doing a very good job. Ivan Diggs right there coming under pressure. Wide open receiver. Pressure causes an incomplete pass. If Fort Valley continues to do this and have success, they're going to win this football game. If Albany State does not protect their quarterback any better, then I think some of these incomplete passes are going to turn into interceptions.
Diggs leading the Wildcats and tackles coming into this game with 51. You got two receivers down at the bottom of your screen. They're running the option, and it's Porter. Maybe a pickup of 1. Rushed out of bounds by Love for Love's second tackle of the game.
String it out, string it out, string it out. They did a very good job, Fort Valley did. Very good job of keeping that play going lateral, not allowing the running back to turn, get his shoulder square to the line of scrimmage and turn up the field. Got him in another third and long situation, and I would be shocked if Fort Valley didn't blitz.
For 3rd and 9 here, Porter and Johnson in the backfield. Flakes out of the shotgun. Two receivers up top, and Flakes looking to his left. He's going to pull it under and try to run for the first down. Makes a nice move inside the five, and he lowers his shoulder down to about the 2-yard line for a 16-yard gain.
Outstanding recognition by Keyson Flakes of the overload blitz to his right. He knew it was coming. He knew that his escape route was going to be on the left side. He does a very good job being decisive. Right here, he's deciding, I'm running with the football. Great cutback right there. Now watch him lower his head. Bam! Fall forward for an extra 2 yards. First and goal on the 2-yard line. Outstanding recognition by the quarterback, Keyson Flakes.
Lorani Davis is in the backfield. He leads his club with 5 touchdowns, and Davis lowers his shoulder. And we've got a touchdown. The Rams on the board first here in the Fountain City Classic. A 2-yard plunge. And the Golden Rams, Sterling, doing what they do best, which is run the football.
And let's run it over big Chris Chapman's butt and just allow him to fall in the end zone, and we'll fall forward. And he did an outstanding job of creating a little space just so his running back have an opportunity. And Lorani Davis did a good job of staying in the hole. 6 points later, Albany State has an opportunity now to tack on the extra point.
Torrey Torstensen on for the extra point. And he knocks it through the upright. So the Albany State Rams providing a battering ram, getting on the board first here. Lorani Davis with the first score from 2 yards away. Albany State leads 7-0 in the first quarter. This is the 18th annual Fountain City Classic, but for the first time, they held a Fountain City Classic parade, and Columbus, Georgia loves to host this football game. And you can see the excitement of the fans and the crowd. There was a parade earlier, and the tailgating started as early as about 9 a.m. this morning for a 2 Eastern kickoff. And so far, the crowd getting what they want. That scoring drive from Albany State, 7 plays, 47 yards, 2 minutes and 18 seconds.
Aww. A combination of Keyson Flakes, a quarterback doing what he does, and the power running game, which is, I think, what Albany State definitely wants to do against the smallest Fort Valley State defense.
Patrick Cuff set to kick off for Albany State. And deep is Ivan Diggs, who scoops it up at about his 7-yard line. And Diggs trying to make something happen. Out past the 35 for a 29-yard gain. Before the game, we talked to Keyson Flakes. We talked about this powerful running game.
I think that I'm a dual quarterback. I never really see myself as really too much of a pocket passer. So I like to make things happen. If things ain't open down the field, I can, you know, make the yards by running it, gaining it on the ground. I've always seen myself when I was growing up as always wanting to be like a running back.
He looked like it on that last drive. Looked like a very good running back, too.
First and 10 now for the Wildcats, and Brown can't hit along the football. And now he's in trouble. Cuts back around to the right side, picks up some blocks. And now Brown out across the 40. And he went a long way, but he ended up picking up about 6 yards.
Okay, that might be the second best 6-yard run I have ever seen. Now, I played in the division in the NFL, Fran, with Barry Sanders, so he had a lot of minus 2-yard runs that looked like that. But that was a thing of beauty, because right when Pierre got ready to hit the jets, he dropped the football. And then he had the presence of mind to remain calm, scoop it up, reverse his field, and got some tremendous blocks on the backside.
But let's make sure those blocks were legal.
Blocking it back, above the waist, number 78 on the offense. Penalty is 10 yards from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
Right as he's getting ready to hit the jets, and he had a running lane, but now he just picks it up, and now we're going to start to get these blocks now. And that's just a beautiful yard right there.
Colin Cordell, a call for the clip there on number 78, blocking above the waist, so it's a penalty that moves the Rams back inside their 30-yard line. This is Brown now. And there is no running room on the right side.
Albany State believes that their corners match up with these wide receivers from Fort Valley State very well, which means if we can play man-to-man on the outside, you're probably going to get 8-man front to negate Pierre Brown's running ability. So Fort Valley State, I believe, is going to have to come up with a plan to throw the football, especially in these situations where you had first and 20. Now you got second and 20. I think you're going to have to put the football in the air.
to 2nd and 22. Williams in the shotgun, and 6:20 left now in the first quarter. And Williams looking deep downfield. He has time. Now he rolls out, and he hits Melvin Atuye. Atuye picks up 7 yards there. These are the kinds of situations, Sterling, that this offense didn't want to be in, third and long.
No. No, they did not. You're exactly right. You do not want to be in long yardage situations, because this is not an offense that's able to pick up those situations. And what you lose more than the football is valuable field position, because having to punt the football here would be almost catastrophic the way that Albany State went down and scored on the last drive. So it's imperative that they get close to picking up this third down, force their coach to go for it.
Williams flushed out of the pocket, scrambling on the right side, and he hits Darius Williams. And Williams is close to a first down, but knocked out about a yard short to pick up a 12 yards.
A decision has to be made right here, boy. I mean, you know what? I'm liking what Garrett's doing in the pocket. I mean, he's showing good presence, keeping his head downfield, directing traffic, very good location of the football right there. You know, allowing his guys to catch it and be able to turn upfield and try and pick up yardage. But 4th and 2, Fran, looks like we're going to get ourselves a punt.
Yeah, they're going to bring out Jake Grubbs to punt here and see if they could pin the Rams back deep. Lamontre Williams is deep. And Grubbs, his first punt was 32 yards. Just under 6 minutes left to go here in the first quarter. And it's Williams at his 20. But wrapped up quickly by a host of Rams. When we come back here for the Fountain City Classic, we'll be joined by Rayfield Wright, 2006 Hall of Famer, and here is the man who introduced him at the Hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my signal honor to present to you the newest inductee into the Professional Football Hall of Fame, number 70, Larry Rayfield Wright.
The Albany State Marching Rams show band getting ready for some action at halftime. Albany State up top 7-0 here in the first quarter. Just under 6 minutes left to go. We hope to be joined by Fort Valley State graduate Rayfield Wright on the phone. We're trying to get that hooked up for you. 1st and 10 now. It's Flakes under pressure, and he's brought down by Princeton Dean for a loss of 11. But let's welcome in to Rayfield Wright, who played his not only football here at Fort Valley State, but Ray also played basketball as well, huh? This has always got to be a great thrill for you to see these two teams going at it.
Oh, absolutely, no question about it. We've got a long history, Fort Valley and Albany State. You know, they've always had a great team. I can recall when I played at Fort Valley, in football, I don't believe that we even lost a game back then against Albany. So hopefully it will be a good game today, and hopefully Fort Valley wins.
Brian Porter with a 16-yard gain there.
You know, Ray, when I think about, you know, getting an opportunity to come from Fort Valley and play in the National Football League, end up in the Hall of Fame, what does that say about historical black college football to you?
What it says is that it makes no difference what school you go to. If you have the athletic ability and you don't quit and give up and you keep a positive attitude about yourself and about what you're trying to accomplish, you'll be amazed what the road that God will take you on.
Kasan Flakes now here in the shotgun. The Rams on first down. Porter is wrapped up by Jeff Peoples. In Rayfield, there's a playoff spot on the line here, and Sterling and I are going to get into that in just a minute, but a Division II playoff spot for the winner of this football game. As if this game needs any more juice here, it certainly makes it just a bit more meaningful.
Oh, absolutely. You know, when you're entering the playoffs, you know, it's always a positive thing. And, you know, for two teams such as Albany and Fort Valley having the chance to get into the playoffs, it means a lot. It will mean a lot to either school, the one that that wins the game.
All right, Randy Allen there with a 46-yard punt. Antoinis Cutts with a fair catch. So, Mr. Wright, your Ford Valley State Wildcats set to get going on offense here.
Well, you know, maybe if things don't get better, maybe I'll put my suit on and come down there and see what I can do.
I like that. And you know what? I think they can use an offensive lineman that could move and get out and lead the toss sweep like they're running right here with Pierre Brown, trying to get him going outside. So that might bode well for him. I mean, I'm going to give you one more play off, and then I'm probably going to have to ask for you to come on in the game.
Just one more time for the fans.
There you go.
Rayfield, talk to me about your basketball career as we wait to see what the flag on the play is. But you were, in many ways, a better basketball player than you were a football player when you were at Fort Valley State.
Oh, absolutely. Remember, I couldn't even make the high school football team, but, you know, I never quit. And basketball was my favorite. It was my passion. And I got very good. I averaged 21 points a game, 28 points a game, 21 rebounds there at Fort Valley for about 3 years.
As a matter of fact, the Dallas Cowboys that called you in 1967 there, were you a bit surprised?
Yes, I was. I was very much surprised because I didn't have my mind set on football. I was looking at basketball because the Cincinnati Royals, back when Oscar Robertson was with them, they named the Sacramento Kings, but they pursued me and wanted me to come and try for the basketball team in Cincinnati.
Now, Chris Tennyson, the Wildcats called for holding there. A moving Fort Valley State back. It's now first and 18. Hang on for a second, Rayfield. Williams out of the shotgun and now keeps it himself. He crosses the 20 for a 6-yard gain. Stopped by Ryan Davis. Those Cowboy teams you played on in the 70s were very special. 5 Super Bowl appearances and you guys won 2 Super Bowls. Just your recollections of playing for the Dallas Cowboys in the 70s.
You know, we had a great team back then, and one thing that we recognized, and especially playing under a great coach like Coach Tom Landry, is that you win as a team and you lose as a team. And we were not individuals, we were a team, and we knew that. So I never will forget when Coach Landry moved me offensive tackle, he said, "Rayfield, you got the speed, quickness, and you learn fast." Said, "I want you to remember something, even though you may receive a lot of accolades and awards, but you will never be greater than the team."
All right, all the way from Fort Valley State to the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 2006. Rayfield Wright, thank you very much for joining us on what we know is a very special day for you.
Thank you so much. And Shannon was a great ball player within himself. Matter of fact, he played the position that I played in Fort Valley.
You were a tight end?
That's right. Yeah, at first.
Absolutely.
Man,
I made the Cowboys as a tight end for 2 years, my first 2 years.
You're just athletic. That's all that is. You're just an athlete, aren't you?
Well, that's what happens when you play, you know, in smaller schools, you know, and you do a lot, you know, and you know, and we've had so many great athletes coming from all of the small schools around Savannah State, Albany, Fort Valley, and, you know, it's just amazing.
All right, Rayfield Wright, thanks for joining us, sir.
Well, thank you, guys. You guys take care, Shannon.
All right, you too.
All right.
Okay.
Garrett Williams with a big 21-yard connection with Melvin Atuye on a 3rd and 15, and prior to that, the Wildcats had not made a first down, but they get it there. 1st and 10 now at their 41.
And a beautiful throw by Garrett. I mean, a beautiful strong arm throw out to the right there. Did an outstanding job of standing in the pocket in the face of pressure and delivered a strike, and his wide receiver finished it off. Melvin did a great job of getting that first down yards after the catch.
Pierre Brown, just 1 yard there, running into the brick house. That is Derek Battle, the senior out of Leslie, Georgia, 305 pounds. And let's talk about the playoff implications here, Sterling. The way it works in Division II, there are 4 regions, and these teams play in the Southeastern region. The top 6 teams in the region go to the playoffs. Right now, Fort Valley State is ranked 6th, Albany State ranked 9th. But for all intents and purposes, just to dumb it down for you, the winner is in.
Is in, yes. And so, that's what makes it a little more special, because Albany State's players have been on the winning side of this game, so they don't know any different. And so when you look at what Fort Valley is playing for, an opportunity to get back to the playoffs, This is a big football game. Hey, they got Fran Charles and Sterling Sharp, NFL Network, coming to town. It's a monumental football game, and this may springboard your program, not only with recruiting, being on the NFL Network, but having a chance to beat a recruiting rival in Albany would be huge. So, you know, for both of these football teams, there's a lot at stake, even more than just going to the playoff.
At the first quarter coming to a close, they might be able to get one more snap off. They've got a third and five here after a five-yard gain by Pierre, trying to outrace the game clock. Williams in the shotgun. Two receivers split out right, and he hits Randall for a seven-yard gain. It should be just enough for a first down as we come to a close here in the first quarter.
I like the game plan. Fort Valley has changed their game plan, and that is allowing Garrett Williams to go back and throw the football, and he's throwing it beautifully.
All right, first quarter in the books. The Albany State Golden Rams lead after one, 7-0. It's the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. The Marching Rams band from Albany State are coming into the stadium. Pre-game style, we're going to hear from both bands, the Marching Rams and the Marching Blue Band from Fort Valley State, coming up at halftime. It should be a great show. Both teams trying to put on a great show on the football field. The Wildcats driving now. First and 10 at Albany State's 49-yard line. And it's Pierre deep in the backfield. Does a nice job down the right side for a pickup of 8 yards.
Finally, they got ahead of the down. That run right there put them in second and three or four. But Pierre does a nice job of bouncing this because the defensive end blows this up. And it's supposed to go inside, but he does a nice job bouncing. Nice job getting his shoulder square. Nice job picking up. It looked like a good 7 yards. Puts this Fort Valley football team ahead of down in distance. Now you can take a chance and see if you can't spring a big one and try and get that momentum back that Albany State got with their 7 points.
Now they're loaded to the left side, and it's Brown spinning, but he spins right into the big arms of number 59, Roderick Cummings. Stacks him up for no gain.
I mean, and now you're just in a situation now, it's manageable, it's 3rd and 4 yards. So you know what, they don't have to do anything very special. They could just come back and you know what, nice job by Albany State. Good size, linebackers filling in the hole right there. Did an outstanding job, Freddie Green doing a good job slamming it up in the hole. And now you put it back on the quarterback to be judicious with the football and make a good decision.
Third three here, the Wildcats looking to convert for the third time on third down on this drive. Great move by Williams. As he picks up the first down with a nice move, a 7-yard gain.
Okay, he lost me on that one too, Frank. It was a really classy move because I thought he was dead right there. I thought he was dead. You know, the corner did a good job. He was dead to rights right there. And what he does is, watch him stay committed, doesn't like that. Now he's made up his mind, he's going to run. And that's what you have to do at the quarterback position. Be decisive, especially in plays like this in a game of that magnitude. And Garrett Williams is doing a very good job of being decisive with the football.
He shook the Mordrees McNeil there for the 7-yard pickup. And a third down conversion on this drive. Now it's Brown on the pitch down the left side.
Pierre Brown.
7 tough yards for Brown. He's stopped by Isaiah Gay.
Doing a good job of mixing in a little run with a little pass, running a little right, running a little left, balancing the football field, forcing Albany State's defense to defend the entire football field. So the game plan right now, and Leon Perry, the offensive coordinator for Fort Valley, is doing a very good job of now getting his football team in manageable situations. And look where they are. They're just outside the 25-yard line and doing a very good job of managing not only the clock, but the way this offense is moving the football.
There you see wideout that Nate Randall, he was shaking up on the play. He was able to get off on the field by himself. Second and a short two. They try Brown now to the right side, but he's wrapped up by Mario Fuller, who actually leads
Albany State in tackles. He had 61 coming into the game. It's his first of today. It's a loss of three.
I believe that's the first time that I think I'm going to put that on Pierre Brown, because he wanted to get outside and there was nothing for him, nothing that told him to go outside. Strong safety spilling on the outside. That's one of those that you got. You know what? Defenses, they have meetings too. They have practice too, and they're wearing pads. So that's where you stick your foot in the ground and you head north and south, and you get the 2 yards that the play is probably going to get.
And is that something you have to learn, Sterling, as you mature? Because a lot of players want to bounce it outside.
Yes, it is. You have to show patience. You have to have an understanding that every play is not meant to go for 40 yards and a touchdown.
Big 25-yard run there from Garrett Williams on the quarterback draw. Mario Fuller was able to wrap him up. But great blocking up front, Sterling.
Did a nice job of being patient in the hole, allowing the defensive linemen to pick and choose where they were going. And, I mean, look at great lead in there. Offensive linemen doing a real good job. And this guy is not very fast, but, man, that's 25 yards on a little quarterback draw. He didn't show a whole lot of speed, but, man.
Well, he's long. I mean,
he's very long.
220 pounds. He's got a little bit. I don't want to get crazy. Yeah. But a little bit of Vince Young in with the way he got the deceptive speed.
Yes, he does. And actually, now that you're looking at him, he looks a little bit like B.Y.
All right, Williams didn't like what he saw as he came up to the line, so he called timeout. DeAndre Clark's club knocking at the door. The Wildcats trail Albany State 7-0 in the second quarter.
Save with Geico Motorcycle Insurance.
Fort Valley State looking to tie up the Fountain City Classic. They have a first and goal at the 5-yard line. And it's Pierre Brown on the pitch. Down to about the 2. He tried to scramble in.
Well, he got more than the play should have gotten, because the corner is just standing out there and nobody blocks it. I mean, they got far too many people on the right side of the offense, and the corner is standing basically in the hole. Corner's going to show up right here and doesn't make that tackle. So very good balance, but I'm not sure he was down right there. I mean, very scrappy run by Pierre right there.
They gave him a yard on the play, so it's second and goal from the 4. Two receivers split wide left. Nate Randall back in the game, so obviously the injury wasn't too bad. Brown alone in the backfield. And it's a fake pitch to Brown, but the Rams don't bite, and now Williams throws it away.
Now, a lot of people say that's a negative play. Outstanding decision by Garrett by getting outside the pocket, realizing that it was supposed to be a naked bootleg. There's no other play. He's keeping this football. And what he does is right here, he knows, I got nothing. So now he just tries to get his shoulders around, throws the football over his wide receiver's head out of bounds. Third down, we got another opportunity to get this football in the end zone.
Nice job by Roderick Cummings of
staying
making
home.
Sure that he stayed home.
Oh, yeah, he stayed home. He did a nice job. I mean, he wanted to bite in on it, but he did a really nice job and forced Garrett to belly by some more yardage there on the bootleg. So it was a really nice job by the Albany State defense.
The Wildcats will try to convert their fourth third down on this drive. This one would be for a touchdown. Williams taking pass all the way, and now in trouble at the right, but he finds Nate Randall for the touchdown.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say right now that we're going to have the MVP trophies at the end of this game to both of these quarterbacks, because they're doing a fantastic job of extending the play. He dropped back to pass, and guess what? It wasn't there. He used his legs, bought some more time, extended that play, and then made an outstanding throw. Here's the first play, phase of the play. Nothing there, pressure coming. Secondary phase of the play, beautiful strike right there to Nate Randall, and did a great job catching it in his hands. Tell him we're going to hand the quarterbacks here the MVP trophies the way they're playing.
Grubbs on for the extra point to tie the game up at 10:29 in the second quarter. So the Wildcats answer, and the Fountain City Classic tied up with Garrett Williams hooking up with Nate Randall.
T
So the Wildcats answer with a pretty impressive drive. 15 plays, 75 yards in 8 minutes and 16 seconds, culminating with a Williams to Randall 4-yard touchdown strike. And we're tied up at 7-all, and Jake Grubbs now will kick it deep. Back deep, Porter and Demetrius Johnson. And it's Johnson at his 8. Out across the 25, 30, he's got daylight. Johnson down the left side, 40, inside the 30, and he's knocked out of bounds. Demetrius Johnson with a huge kickoff return, 79 yards. And here come the Golden Rams.
You really don't like to beat up the word patience, but I want you to watch how slow this kick return develops. It's the left return, and look how long it takes him to get to the wall. He makes one cut, and he's down the sidelines. And now it's just a foot race, and the big fella's chugging. And he's about to run out of gas, and they do a good job of trapping him on the sideline. But boy, Albany State now is in business right now.
Brett McCullough knocked him out of bounds to save a touchdown. It's first and 10 for the Rams.
A delay of game? Stop.
Wow.
This can't be. Yeah, well, the play clock says zero, so I guess it could be a delay of game.
Here's Rod Holloway with the call.
Substitution infraction. The defense, 12 men in the formation, yep. 5 yards, remains first down.
Great 80-yard run by Demetrius Johnson, and you mentioned Sterling, the patience, and the big fella showing that he can get out in the open field and get down the field.
And that's exactly what this football team needed, sitting on the sidelines for 8 minutes offensively, and now Albany State has a short field to work with the points.
First and goal at the 8-yard line. Great hesitation move by Porter, and Porter gets in for the quick six.
I don't even think I saw him. He was so wide open. And I mean, great job of great fake. Really good by the offensive line of creating just enough space so he can walk in untouched. Let me see if I got this straight. This is a one-play drive.
That's right. One play, 8 yards.
And that's a beautiful hole on the backside. And you know what? Brian Porter did a good job of, once again, here's that word, showing patience, staying in the hole, play side, finding it at the last possible minute for the score.
Torrey Tortstedson on for the extra point, and it's good. So just like that, the Golden Rams strike back for their second touchdown of the game. They lead 14-7. Sterling, a Porter's 6th touchdown of the year.
And I mean, watch this. He stays play side to right there. Now he just bounces in the hole backside, walks in untouched. Beautiful design, great execution, and that's why they find themselves ahead 14-7 in this football game.
I tell you what, if you're growing up in Georgia and you want to play football, this is a great showcase for us. And Albany State head coach Mike White said he loves the atmosphere for this game.
This is one of the schools that we go up against in terms of recruiting. So there's a lot of players they were signed last year. We signed last year that we were in battles over. Again, it gives us an 8-win season, which is a game better than we were last year. And again, it just gives you pure bragging rights for a year.
And right now, Mike White's club is leading in the bragging rights department, up 14-7. But also keep in mind, there's a playoff spot on the line. The first playoff game, Division II, coming up in a couple of weeks.
But that's the thing, is you can't focus on one thing in a game of this magnitude. You can't just say the playoff spot, because you know what? They're recruiting the same people. You heard Coach White just mention it. And now you got recruiting, you got playoffs, you got NFL Network. You got another kick return that looks like it's going to pop for a big one.
Ivan Diggs.
Oh, my.
He picked it up at about his 21-yard line, and Diggs going 50 yards after the short kickoff by Patrick Cuff.
So in the game of this magnitude, nobody's going to play special teams. Is that it? He runs up. He's almost down back. Almost goes to a knee right here. And look how he just finds that crease. I mean, beautiful job of returning the football. Stays in bounds. Does a really nice job. I mean, you know what? These two football teams understand this magnitude. and they're doing a fantastic job of responding to the pressure and the big plays. So, I mean, this back and forth, outstanding return to set his offense up on a short field as well.
You know, Dedrick Dodge, the defensive coordinator, played 7 years in the National Football League, won a couple of Super Bowl rings with the Niners and the Broncos. He told us you can't keep Ivan Diggs still.
No.
Diggs always wants to be near the action. Williams trying to buy some time. We're looking deep downfield, but he can't find Chris Tennyson.
Who he should have been looking for is he should have been looking for his tight end, because his tight end, Gerald Hall, was wide open in the middle of the field. He had just broken free, and if he'd come back just to the goalpost, he had number 86 standing there wide open, but also a little better throw, and that right there would have been a touchdown. I mean, Chris had gotten a step. Chris Tennyson had gotten a step, but a little better location of the football, and you still got the play you want from Fort Valley. I mean, it's just a little better location on the football, just a little better. And you can see at the top of your screen where the football is, you get a chance to see a guy wide open, a little better foot location, still got yourself a touchdown.
Williams, a 6-9 so far for 48 yards and a touchdown. Trips left, tried to swing it out to Atuye, but Atuye was flipped around and he couldn't grab his hands around the football.
Location of the football. If you locate that football where he gets an opportunity to catch it running north-south, you're going to get yourself a first down. If he breaks a tackle, he's going to end up in the end zone. So the last two throws by Garrett Williams, location of the football. It's like real estate. Extremely important. Bad location of the football gives you a negative play. Now you're in that third and 10 situation, and you may be, what, 5-6 yards outside of the range of a kicker that is kicking the football well but might be out of his range right now.
For the season, they're 29% on conversion rate of a third down, but they're 5-for-7 for this game, and make it 6-for-8. Tennyson slips a tackle, and he's inside the 10 for a 20-yard gain.
Location of the football, Fran Charles, allows yards after the catch. And Dedrick Dodge, playing in San Francisco, had a great chance to watch John Taylor and Jerry Rice do their thing. Look at the location. I can catch it, protect myself, and get north-south. And that is the play, and that's how important location of the throws are from the quarterback position, because these wide receivers, extremely athletic, and all they need is an opportunity to make a big play for you.
Another four wide receiver set, three out to the left. Williams with the quick fake, trying to take it himself, but he's wrapped up by Ryan Davis. Davis with his fifth tackle so far in the game. It's a loss of one.
Pierre Brown, the running back, is the lead blocker on this quarterback draw, and he didn't do a very good job of finding the guy he was supposed to block, because the guy who made the tackle, that's Pierre Brown's guy. If he blocks him, Garrett Williams is standing in the end zone, going in untouched.
Been a nice offensive showdown here. Both teams doing fairly well with a total of 9 first downs. Second and goal now. And the Wildcats still rumbling there.
Tossed him out of the hole. He did everything correctly on this play. Pierre Brown did everything correctly. He got tossed out of the hole going to his left, friend. He switches the football, gets it in his outside arm, and then he plants that foot in the ground and tries to get upfield and get positive yardage. You know what? Defensive guys have meetings. They have practice. They have coaches. They also have a game plan, and their game plan right now against Pierre Brown is almost perfect.
That was Chris Watson there with a loss of one, so here we go. It's third and goal from the 11. Williams looking. He wants to dump it off, but he's being chased. Oh, and he gets a block and a flag, a block below the knee, so this, whatever happens on this play, it's coming back. Great catch by Atuye. But it's coming back most definitely. Roy Holloway.
And that's the San Francisco 49er, Denver Bronco, protect the blind lineman's knees. And that's what that was, because on the return coming back, all he had to do was stay up. If he stays up, he's got a great opportunity for a touchdown. But the offensive lineman is working for his quarterback. He sees his quarterback in trouble. And right there on the left of your screen, unprotected lineman. You can't go after his knees. I love the rule. I love the call. I love the throw and the catch for sure. But if he stays up right there,
79,
I mean, he's got a great block.
On the offense, 10-yard, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot.
And I like it. I like that call. I mean, you got to protect guys not looking. They're playing as hard as you are. And then to have a guy crack back and cut him below the, I mean, that's a career ender right there. And that's why I know the NFL did a good job of changing this rule. Looked like college did a good job of making this rule. 15-yard penalty. I mean, it was a good play trying to help out your quarterback. But the penalty yards now.
They called it on 79. They said Jerome Schultz, but it was really number 57, Romar Douglas, who got Derek Battle here. So now we got a third and forever. Third and goal from the 28. Three receivers set off to the top of your screen to the left side. Williams in trouble, and he's wrapped up by a threesome. Armstrong, the first to get there. It's a loss of 11. And an important lesson for the Wildcats to learn here, because you got a first and goal at the 10. You just took the field goal right off the board.
Well, you take the field goal off the board because your quarterback has been making plays like this all day. And then you got an offensive lineman that tries to help him out, picks up a 15-yard penalty. So you know what? You go back out there and you say, defense, we need a stop. Got a big kick return. Now we need our defense to get a stop.
So now it's fourth and goal from the 39 and Jake Grubbs. Set the punt, and he shanks it. And it takes a Golden Rams bounce. So punting from his 39, it's a 14-yard punt.
I was about to say it was a good punt, but it wasn't.
Albany State dodges a huge bullet. Stands are packed here at A.J. McClung Memorial Stadium. If you want a seat, you better find one on the hill. And from 1916 to 1958 that they played the Georgia-Auburn game here, 42 years, the deepest rivalry in the Old South.
Okay.
That's what they call it.
Hey, okay.
That's what they call it.
Okay. I'm just making sure you had your information
okay,
right there.
Right.
I'm just checking.
All right, first and 10 for the Golden Rams at their own 23.
Go.
Play clock ticking down to zero. They don't get it off. So they're moving back 5 yards with the delay.
Delay of game. Number 11 on the offense. Yard penalty remains first down.
You can't come out of a timeout and have a delay again. It's just, I don't know how you do it. I mean, he just did it, but you can't come out of a timeout and have a delay again.
Albany State looking to get back to what has made it successful. They've run the ball 12 times and passed it 4. And here's Lorani Davis. For a 3-yard game.
But you got Ivan Diggs, and they're throwing himself in there early. And you know, Ivan is a strong safety, and talking to Dedrick about Ivan, you know, it's one of those guys that we want to play him at safety, but he ain't gonna stay in the middle of the field. He's not gonna stay on a hash 12, 14 yards deep. He's got to be up near the line of scrimmage, and looks like he's coming again.
They give it to the man up front, Demetrius Johnson. And Johnson showing not only can he return kickoffs, but he picks up a nice chunk of yards there.
Outstanding play call versus a blitz, because if you can pop the fullback through that first wave, like he pops right here, now all he's got to do is stay out on the track. Stay out on the track. If he stays left, he's probably still running. But a good trap block, did a real nice job of finding that hole, and now just stay out. You know what? It's not going to be a 100-yard run.
15 yards for the first down. Blake's just barely gets it off. Big hole for Johnson. Johnson now trying to make a move, getting a great block downfield from Ronnie Childs before he's wrapped up by Eddie Young.
Once again, Ivan Diggs comes on the blitz untouched up the middle. And what you do, you pop the fullback. If you get the fullback through that, I mean, look at this hole. It's just a little sweep draw, and then you pop the fullback versus that blitz. I mean, he runs right by Ivan, who blitzing sacks the quarterback, Kasan Flakes, and now you got a guy running free in your secondary.
And Sterling, you had to be proud of Childs there, the wide receiver.
Nice
blocking way downfield, huh?
I mean, you know, a man after my own heart, friend. I blocked just like, well, not really that good.
Flakes now in the shotgun. It was a 38-yard gain, first and 10 at the 21, and they're moving to the right with the option, and he pitches it off to Brian Porter. Porter gets it inside the 20 to the 19 for a pickup of three. It'll be second and seven with 5:20 left here in the second quarter.
Well, I mean, it's two great scheme plays because you pop your fullback versus a blitz. Two great scheme plays. And now look at Albany State settling down, taking their time at the line of scrimmage. It's not no huddle. It's like a sugar. We just call the huddle at the line, call the play at the line of scrimmage, and we're not in a big hurry, but we're just gonna line up and keep these guys ready to play.
They have three players on that the front line, over 300 pounds. Tim Johnson, 385, and they are moving on the Wildcats back. Here's Porter now, and he's stacked up by a host of Wildcats. Pick up a one.
Metal and road right here. It's just, you know, our strength against your strength. And you got the interior guys that did a good job on the front four, but didn't do a very good job getting up on their secondary responsibilities and getting those linebackers out of the hole. So, you know what? Good defensive play by Fort Valley, and they're going to have to come up with another one right here just to get off the field. And I like the sprint option down to the field. I like the sprint option this way.
The Golden Rams are only converted on one third down. They flip it out to Porter. Porter with a nice stutter step. Down inside the 10, lowers his head.
I love that play.
Enough to pick up the first down. Steven Bostic blasted him out of bounds, not before Porter was able to pick up 10.
I love that play, Fran, because you get outflanked as a defense right now. I mean, because the backs are set so far left, you're outflanked already. So he kicks it out there. You got a guy, he's outflanked. There's nothing he can do because once he breaks down, guess what? He gives up that little outside move there, pick up of 10 yards, got yourself a first down. So I love the play call. I like this formation that I'm seeing from Albany State. The offset eye looks like a spread offset eye, but do a very good job running the option to the field because it outflanks you right now.
All right, so say a little bit about these two schools and who's involved. Fort Valley State Wildcats, founded in 1895, just over 2,500 enrolled in the school. As you see, Johnson picking up 4 yards.
In Fort Valley, I mean, you're talking about historical black college football and you know, Fort Valley, Albany State, Savannah State, you know, FAMU, all these historical black colleges. You know, a lot of guys getting an opportunity to play at the next level. A lot of guys getting an opportunity to get their college diplomas. So, you know, Fort Valley and their enrollment doing a very good job supporting the football program. And you know what? Looks like the football program is starting to come back to respectability and prominence because what they do on the field is a direct translation of what the student body, because the student body pays for these football players to have the opportunity to play here.
Lorani Davis stuffed there by Chris Riddles for no gain. We'll get back to Albany State here. Third and goal. Porter deep now. He's got 39 yards and looking for his second TD of the game. He takes it on the flip. And he's lit up. Some hard hitting going down there. A pickup of three.
Porter runs to the three.
And so now it's decision time.
Ooh. I mean, it looks like they're going to kick it. But with that size of that offensive line, I would really be tempted to go for this one. I mean, for the size of that offensive line, I would really be tempted to go for this one.
But Rashad Smith lost his helmet on that play. He was popping so hard. It's Patrick Cuff now on for the 20-yard field goal. Cuff, 4-7 on the year, and it's blocked. It's blocked. And it's Reggie Hughes. Hughes has his hands on the rock, and he's got two men to beat. Great job, though, by the Golden Rams to catch Hughes. It's a 58-yard return on the block.
With the size of the Albany State offensive line, there is no way I'm kicking that football from right there. But give Fort Valley some credit. They showed up, came up with the block right up the middle. We got to have pressure up the middle right now. And that's it. Oh, number 48.
That's
coming
right, Jeff Peoples.
Just off the right side of your screen. Did a good job of getting this. And look at him. Everybody's looking up for the ball. All right, now you're a blocker. Now turn and block. Come on, 3-1. Turn and block, baby. Turn and get somebody. And he does a good job of just enough, getting in the way just enough And boy, that piano jumped on his back right there. And when the piano jumps on your back, ain't nothing you can do about it.
Chad Bryant was there to help bring down Reggie Hughes, but not before Hughes rumbles 58 yards. And that is a huge play so far in this game. Williams in trouble, tried to throw it away. Surprised, don't see a flag there. And there, well, now we see one. That's probably going to be for unsportsmanlike conduct. Williams was trying to buy some time, but he spun right into the arms.
After the play, unsportsmanlike, number 10 on the offense, 15 yards, second down.
Catastrophic. That's what that was. It was a negative play. It was a negative play from the start. Now, if you're not going to let it go right there, he's trying to make a mountain out of a molehill. Can't do it. Now, okay, the referee says you're down right there. Now, watch his reaction. You're down right there. Now he says something to the official. It's what he says right there that gets him the unsportsmanlike conduct. So now we go from first and 10 on the 34-yard line.
Well, you know, it's interesting enough. It seemed like Garrett Williams thought he was going to get flagged for intentional grounding and was trying to point to a receiver that was in the vicinity of his pass, and the flag never came for that.
But he was so close to the official,
right,
that, you know what, with the flag being on, why don't you wait and get the call? Because you know what, you're either going to officiate or you're going to play.
But he,
Garrett's job is to play,
correct,
not to officiate.
And he was arguing a flag that was never thrown, as there you see Tennyson just drops the ball.
Yeah, he was saying that, you know, I had a receiver in the area, but the official was saying you were down by contact right here. You're down right here. And so, I can't even explain this one. I mean, because I did a good job explaining the penalty, but a drop is a drop. I can't even begin to explain how you drop it like that unless your concentration and Chris Tennyson maybe just took his eyes off the football.
All right, so on second and long, Tennyson gets another chance, and this time he's able to corral it for a pickup of 13.
Okay, now I can explain it. You hit him in the chest with the football. Don't ever hit a wide receiver in the chest with the football. Hit him in the hands. And I know you're saying that Chris didn't put his hands up. Well, maybe that's because his hands were busy. So if you hit a wide receiver in the hands, chances are he can catch it. If you hit him in the chest, you got no chance.
Third and 22 now.
I'm gonna figure this game out. One way or another, I'm gonna figure it out.
And a timeout on the field. The officials will huddle together.
Yeah, so this should be fourth down. That's probably what
Check
they're
that.
Discussing because it was a dead ball. It was after the play.
Exactly.
It should
exactly.
be fourth down.
So DeAndre Clark's Wildcats can't catch a break here after a nice blocked field goal and a return of 58 yards.
They just got a break. They blocked the field goal.
They're backing up.
58. They just keep giving up their breaks. They get first and goal, and they end up with two big penalties and out of field goal range. I mean.
All right, so it is fourth down, fourth and 22. Gloves on to punt for the third time today. This one a little better. His last effort was 14 yards. Lamontre Williams back at around the 10. Still on his feet before he's brought down. Yep. Make sure you hang with us here at the halftime at the Fountain City Classic. We will see both bands, Fort Valley State, the Marching Blue Machine first, and then the Albany State Marching Rams show band. And in between there, we'll go back to our NFL Network studio. Spiro Dedis and company will get us set on all the great NFL action for week 9. And everybody's talking about the Pats and Colts.
Are they playing this week?
I think they are still. Who do you think is going to win that game?
I've been so wrapped up with Albany State and Fort Valley State, I didn't even notice they were playing.
You might be the only one in the country. Okay. This is Demetrius Johnson.
But to answer your question, I like the Colts at home. I mean, I know the
really.
Yeah, I know the high flying act of Randy Moss and Wes Welker and Tom Brady with the 30 touchdowns. Peyton Manning's seen them guys on defense before though. They're not new. you know, Dallas Thomas is a new addition, but the rest of those guys, hey, Peyton Manning is like, oh, we go way back. I've seen what they bring to the table, so I like the Colts at home.
The Golden Rams aren't going to take any chances here, up 14-7. And they hand it off deep to Johnson. Picks up a couple. Looks like Mike White is going to be content to head into the locker room at halftime, up 14-7. It's almost as if we get quickly back to that Pats-Colts matchup. But Bill Belichick is realizing, you know what, the Colts, they've been able to score on us. They've won the last three games. So now let me go out, reload the offense specifically to get by the Indianapolis Colts.
Well, I think also, if you, you know, based on what they do defensively, I mean, if you give them a lead, they're going to pretty much make it hold up. And last year in the championship game, 21-6, the Colts were down coming out of the locker room, and they were able to win the football game 38-34. So I just think that he understands that points come out of the passing game, and he went out and got three good ones to catch the football.
Two quarters of the books here at Columbus, Georgia for the Fountain City Classic. Albany State leads 14-7. When we come back, we'll have a great performance. The Marching Blue Machine Band. We must. Welcome back to AJ McClung Memorial Stadium here in Columbus, Georgia for the Fountain City Classic. Albany State leading Fort Valley State 14-7. Now it's time for the performance to go on. The Fort Valley State Marching Blue Machine Band led by Kevin L. Jones. Take it away.
Yeah.
The Marching Blue Machine doing its thing for Fort Valley State. Still to come from Albany State, the Marching Rams show band. But when we come back, we're going to send it to our NFL Network studios and join Spiro Dedis and Adam Schefter as they get ready for week 9 of the NFL season. Welcome back to NFL Network's coverage of the Fountain City Classic, where Albany State leads 14-7 at the break. The Albany State Marching Rams show band on the field right now with a little Ring My Bell. Let's listen in.
We'll be right back.
Tremendous job by the Marching Rams show band here as we get set for the second half kickoff. Albany State leads 14-7 for the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. More when we come back. Welcome back to NFL Network's coverage of the 18th annual Fountain City Classic, where Albany State leads a 14-7 over Fort Valley State. And Fran Charles alongside Sterling Sharp, we saw some good things in the first half.
We really did. And what Albany State was able to do is take advantage of their big plays. And that's why they have the lead in this football game. Got a great opportunity right here. You see the quarterback does a very, Keyson did a very good job of orchestrating this offense, getting them down inside the 2-yard line. From there, they hand it to their big back, goes over from the 2-yard line, puts them up 7-0. Fort Valley did an outstanding job of bouncing back in this football game, and their quarterback, Barron Williams, did a great job of using his legs to continue plays, and that's why they were able to tie the football game up at 7, but then immediately after that score, the big kickoff return. And when you get a kickoff return like this, that will allow you to control tone, tempo, put your football team on a very short field. Demetrius Johnson right here is going to run this football, get down the sideline, did an outstanding job. Short field, which now sets it up for Brian Porter, number 23, to come into your living room untouched and unfazed. And when you look at the first half numbers, all you have to pay attention to is the fact that the numbers, yardage, look at the rushing yards for Albany State, did an outstanding job. Don't have to throw the ball when you can get this kind of production from the running game. The penalties are what killed Fort Valley State, 6 for 70 yards, because those were big penalties. And if you stay in football games by not beating yourself, Fort Valley State does not lead in this football game because their penalty yardage beat them in the first half.
Fort Valley State that won the kickoff at the beginning of the game, elected to defer and receive in the second half. So this is Ivan Diggs planting at the 9. And he's got some room up the right side. Ball comes out, but the officials ruled that he was down.
And he was
out at about the 37 for a 30-yard gain. It's the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. Albany State leads the series 13-4, but this series goes way back. This is actually the 61st game between these two teams, and Fort Valley State leads that 31-26, and three times they tie. These two schools are very even.
Yes.
If you look at how they performed throughout history.
And they're very even on how they perform today, friend. They have not run the ball very well. One team's run it better than they've thrown it. Right there, you get a bad location of the football, so you get yourself an incomplete pass. But these two football teams are quarterback dominant, lean on their quarterbacks to get them in and out of bad plays, use their legs to continue plays. So these two football teams are not only in the history of playing each other, but they played similarly today as well.
Garrett Williams with the bullet looking for Melvin Atuye there, but Mario Fuller breaking it up. So it'll be second down and 10 from the 37 for the Wildcats. Trips left. And Williams passing again for the second straight down. He goes to the right side. And it's caught by Chris Tennyson. It's a pickup of 9. So it'll be a short third and 1.
I don't believe when they put this offense in this week that Chris Tennyson was going to have this many opportunities to catch the football. I just think that when they go trips to one side, he seems to be drawing the single coverage. That single coverage is often inside, so he's been able to run out routes on Albany State's defense all day long, and other than the big drop he had, he's done a very good job of catching the football. The
Tennyson, 3 catches for 40 yards. He only had 6 coming into the game. And there you see a Terry McGee, the cornerback for the Golden Rams, their star on defense. He's just 5'10", about 162. He's a sophomore. He's broken up more passes than any other player in the Southern Intercollegiate Athletic Conference, but in large part because teams like to throw to him.
They really want to test him, make sure he's a complete football player, and that is what he is. That's why he gets a lot more opportunities in the game, and he's done a fantastic job of standing up to that pressure.
He's got a couple of tattoos, football is life, and also another one, laugh now, cry later. This guy's all about football. Williams on the rollout to the left, and he hits Darius Williams in stride. Williams inside the 45 to the 43 for an 11-yard gain.
You know, Fran, when a lot of America gets an opportunity to watch historical black football games on TV, or if they happen to go to a game, they may not think they're going to see a technically sound football team or a football player. But Garrett did a great job. Garrett Williams did a quarterback. Great job of unlocking that left hip, getting the shoulders around, and throwing an absolute strike rolling to his left, which is a very tough throw for a right-handed quarterback.
And they've come out throwing here in the second half. The Wildcats down by 7. The pitch now. And a nice run from Pierre Brown. 8 yards on the play.
I mean, you know what? Now they're starting to get into a rhythm, because Garrett Williams threw the football very well in the first half. And he did a lot of that having to move around in the pocket. But now we get the toss out the right. Fullback does a good job going back inside, getting his man on the ground. There's one guy we can't block. That guy belongs to you. The corner end up making a tackle, gain of 8 yards.
DeAndre Clark loves these second and short situations. Williams in the shotgun immediately rolls out to his left and now tries to buy some time, breaks back to the middle of the field and just throws it away.
Very good defense by Albany State on the rollout to the left. Had everybody secure. Everybody had a man standing next to him. So nowhere for Garrett Williams to go with the football. Did a very good job trying to see if he could buy some time. Could not. Threw the football away. Still got third and short yardage.
Fort Valley State did an exceptional job on third down conversions. 7 of 10 in the first half. They were stuck at 29% for the season coming in. So they've been able to figure things out. On third down, this is a short third and 1. You got 2 receivers to the right. Williams with the shotgun, and it's Brown on the draw. Almost wrapped up there.
It'll
be close.
I can't wait to watch this spot, because I thought he got there. I thought he got it right on the line before they drove him out of bounds, but then they may have grasped his face mask, and they may pick it up anyway.
O'Brien Russell riding Brown out of bounds, so presumably at first saving a first down for the Golden Rams. If there's a flag on the play, let's check.
Incidentally, grab another face mask. Number 13 on the defense. 5-yard penalty added to the end of the run. First down.
So it wasn't a flagrant. It wasn't a 15-yard penalty, but it was 5. And 5 is still more than enough for a first down. So the drive continues for the Wildcats.
So number 13 accidentally grabbed a face mask and rode him out of bounds. My bad. I didn't mean to. That was my bad. I'm sorry. So that's a 5-yarder. Okay. If that's the way they saw it on the field, Fran, that's the way they saw it on the field.
Sounds like you're not buying it. All right. First and 10 at the 29. A quick pitch to Brown. And Brown now starting to get enough carries to get into a groove. Donald Hannah takes him down, but not before a gain of 5.
Very nice point, Fran. get enough carries to get into a groove. And that's what he is. He is not a one-hit wonder or a four-carry wonder. He's a guy that needs to get in a rhythm so he can get his sea legs under him, so he can start to set his blocks up from his offensive lineman. And you know what? I think this is a great game plan that Fort Valley comes out of the locker room with, mixing in the run and pass. I think they'll throw on first down, mix in a run on first down as well. So doing a very good job of making Albany State defend every square inch of the field.
Three wide receivers to the right. Williams was looking left, throws it across the field, but on one hop, and it's incomplete. Nate Randall can't come up with it.
All right, that's his second mistake that he's made today. The 15-yard personal foul penalty. He got arguing with the referee. That was the first mistake. He just made his second one because he doesn't have to move. If he stands in the pocket, just stand there. He's got nowhere to. He doesn't have to go anywhere, and he runs himself into an almost sack. That's what athletic quarterbacks do. That's why when you look in the history of the National Football League, for instance, the most sack quarterbacks are guys that are mobile because they run into more than they run away from.
Yeah, almost ran right into the arms of Billy Ray Morris.
Exactly.
A big third and six here. Williams on the shotgun, keeping himself in the draw. Nothing doing. A pickup of 1 yard. He ran right into the arms of the big fella, Joshua Ingram. 6'6", 305-pound freshman.
How can you be a freshman at 6'6", 305 pounds? I mean, you can't be a freshman at 6'6", 305. You have to be at least a junior.
A lot of eats there.
If you're going to be 6'6", 305, you're going to be a junior.
All right, Jake Grubb's on now to try to cut the lead to just four for the Golden Rams. And head coaches don't like to talk about kickers, but DeAndre Clark was more than happy to talk about this guy. Sterling, I believe you know his nickname.
Sugarfoot.
From 42 yards away.
Sugarfoot, and he's ready.
All right, the ball down. And Grubbs sneaks it in there.
Sugar, baby. Sugar.
For a 42-yarder.
Sugar delivery.
And don't count out the Wildcats just yet. Back with much more from the Fountain City Classic after this. So DeAndre Clark's Fort Valley State Wildcats come right out of the locker room. They go 10 plays for 39 yards. Jake Grubbs knocks down a 42-yard field goal, eating up 3 minutes and 49 seconds to get right back in this ball game, 14-10.
But now the special teams have got to start playing now. We had two big returns after points put on the board. We had a blocked field goal. So now it's time for the special teams to settle down in this football game and nullify some of the big returns we've seen.
Grubbs, the kickoff from the 30. Johnson lets it bounce. He scoops it up at the 15 and goes right up the middle. Boy, he runs hard. Demetrius Johnson, 18 yards.
Very good balance, too, Fran. I mean, he is very under control when he runs the football.
And so here comes Kasan Flakes. And the Golden Rams offense getting its first opportunity in the second half. Flakes did a nice job on the opening drive for the Rams.
Yeah, yes, he did.
They will start in the shotgun with three receivers bunched up on the left side. Flakes looking left, and now he pulls it down. Gets to the 40, and he is stuck by Ivan Diggs.
Wherever the football is, you're probably going to find number seven. You're going to find number seven, either returning it or somewhere near it. But you see Kasan Flakes goes back in the pocket. He's going to move around, and then number seven's going to go track him down. Go get him, number seven. He just tracks him down. So a good offensive play, gain of about 5.5 yards. Very good defensive play to keep that gain to 5.5 yards.
Second and a short five here from the 41. Trips left again. This time it's Brian Porter for 5 yards and a first down, and this time again it's Ivan Diggs on the stop.
Those big uglies up front are doing a very good job of moving the pile. They had a little trap play right there, Fran, which allowed the little running back, you know, get Brian Porter inside under all that beef that they got up front. Little trap play. There's the kick out block right there. He sneaks inside. Bounces around, picks up a gain of 5.5 yards, move the chains, got yourself a first down.
Little no huddle here from the Rams. Flakes calling the play at the line. Out of the I formation. Lorani Davis right up the middle for 3 yards.
I mean, I think because of the size of the offensive line for Albany State, you're only going to negate that size with speed. And in speed, that means you got to put a lot of people at the line of scrimmage and move them around. So it's one of those situations we saw early in the first half. When you get a blitz, if you can pop the fullback past that first wave, you got yourself a big run.
You talk about the size. I didn't mean to cut you off. Still, Montrell Neal, 340 pounds. Chris Chapman, 340 pounds. Tim Johnson, 385 pounds.
I mean, that kind of beat tells me that we're running the football and we really want to run it inside.
Blake's out of the shotgun. He flips it off to his tight end, Larry Johnson. And Johnson inside the 45 down to the 41 for a pickup of 12 yards and a first down.
I'm impressed with both of these offenses, Fran. I thought I was going to come out and see, you know, 3 yards in a cloud of dust all day. But they've done some really cute things offensively. Just slide him out. Slide him out in the flat. The tight end's wide open. And Larry Johnson makes the catch, gets a first down. I'm liking what I'm seeing from both offenses. Now Albany State starting to get their offense in a rhythm, mixing in the run and the pass as well.
8:45 left in the third quarter. The Golden Rams up 14-10 and driving. This is Flakes inside. Gives it off to Johnson for a 5-yard gain.
Patience and power. That's what he brings to the table. Very nice patience on that inside run. Finishes off with very good power, falling forward, picking up a good 4.5, 4¾ of a yard. But a positive play, and you keep your offense on schedule with a 4-yard carry.
Robert Jackson with the stop. Second down and a long five, we'll call it. Johnson deep, Davis up front, and it's Flakes to Johnson. Johnson moving the pile. 4 yards, maybe 5. And it's close to another first down. They move the chains. Chris Miller on the stop.
385, 345, and 340 getting it done right now, Fran. And Fort Valley State is starting to panic a little bit because now we're starting to see more and more people at the line of scrimmage. Corners locked up on the outside, 8-9 man in front to try and slow down this running attack.
That's the 11th first down for the Rams. Davis stuffed there, though, at the line of scrimmage. Reggie Hughes was there, along with Jeff Peebles.
Very nice job. Very nice job up front. You watch the nose right here. Number 95 does a good job. Number 50, number Reggie Hughes gets in there, does a good job. Number 50, Reggie Hughes, is a football player. Talking to Johnny Cole, the head coach of Lane last week, got a chance to play against Fort Valley. He said when he comes in the game, he just finds the football. He's a football playing dude.
All right, loss of one here, so it's 2nd and 11. Flakes under pressure. And he hits Joshua Johnson on his back.
In the face of a blitz, he stood in there and threw a strike. I mean, I'm telling you. I mean, you know, when you think about historical black college football, you think athleticism, quarterbacks running around. I'm impressed with the way these two quarterbacks run their offense and in the face of adversity. I mean, staring down the barrel of a blitz, he stands in there and throws a strike to a wide receiver that loses his footing. I mean, you can't throw any better than that. Great location of football.
You got corners coming off the edges untouched and Flakes hanging in there. Penalty flag down here. Play stop. It's the 12th first down of the game for the Rams.
Offside, 91 on the defense, 5-yard penalty. Lions first down.
All right, Sergio Pengel called for offsides. Sterling Clark was able to talk to DeAndre Clark about blitzing.
I mean, is there something in the game plan that you saw from Albany that allows you to blitz even more?
Yeah, them fat behind linemen up front. Yeah, so they even a little slower than they are on film.
Coach, we will talk to you in a minute. Oh.
All right, it's Blake's on the option to Porter. Porter gets outside, picks up another first down, but there you just get a little taste of DeAndre Clark.
And let me explain what he's talking about a little slower. he doesn't want his guys standing in front of those big bodies and being pushed around, because size-wise, Fort Valley's defensive front is no match for the offensive line of Albany State man-on-man. So what he's doing is blitzing a little bit more to try to get them to move laterally as opposed to just firing off the ball going straight ahead.
First and goal now for the Rams. At the 7-yard line, Flakes from the shotgun, and there's another flag on the play.
He's offsides again. They're offside. They are so anxious to get the quarterback on a blitz that they're jumping offsides.
It's Princeton Dean professing that he didn't do anything
on the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Main first down.
Meanwhile, a number 53, Chris Miller, is face down.
They are so excited to blitz. They are so excited to get going forward, to try and put pressure, to try and cause a turnover, to try and create some momentum for Fort Valley's football team. They're jumping offsides. They're listening to the quarterback instead of looking at the football. And I mean, we saw this in the first half where Fort Valley would beat themselves with the 15-yard penalties. Now they're nickeling and diming themselves to get to death right now.
We are going to step aside and momentarily we'll be back for more of the Fountain City Classic after this. There you see Wildcat linebacker Chris Miller. He was on the field injured, but head trainer Crystal Small and her staff doing a great job of getting him off the field. Looks like he has maybe a knee injury. We'll try to get an update for you as the game progresses. Meanwhile, Davis stacked up after a gain of one for the Rams. There's another flag on the play.
For short gain, penalty marker on the play.
Holding, 6-1 on the offense.
Wow.
10 yards, penalty. First down.
How does the center hold on that play? It's run right up his butt.
Marcus Presley
the world
calls for the hold there, and that could turn out to be a costly penalty. Moving the football easily on the ground.
Yeah, they brought back in Mr. Patience, though. I mean, Demetrius Johnson come back in the football game, and what is it, on the 10, 11, 12 yard, 13-yard line? Probably going to get a blitz, and they're going to probably try and pop the fullback through that first wave of that blitz.
First and goal at the 13 for Albany State, up 14-10. Flakes going to the corner of the end zone, and it's intercepted, but the officials say that he's out of bounds.
Oh, that's textbook. That's textbook right there. I mean, a great job of feeling and falling by the defensive back. He had an opportunity right there. I mean, Eddie Young is in perfect position right here. This, if I had a training reel on how to play the fade route, this would be it, because he's not looking. He's not looking. He's not looking. Now he looks, and he feels and falls, and he replaces the wide receiver, catches the football at the highest point. He just ran out of real estate. That's all.
Young leading the Wildcats defense with 5 interceptions. Flakes dumps it off, and it's complete for a short gain. Robert Taylor.
And you know what? There's a very good chess match going on between Fort Valley's defense and Albany's offense, because Albany State thought they were getting a blitz. That's why the ball came out quick, and it was in the face of a zone defense, and they almost got the turnover that they were looking for.
Third and goal at the 11, spread wide on both sides, a 4-receiver set. Flakes directing traffic. And he's looking over the middle. He hits Lamontre Williams back over the middle, but Williams is wrapped up after a 5-yard gain.
Coach is thinking about it. Go for it. Go for it, coach. Go for it. Coach gave the signal to go for it. And I believe they're going for it. Coach is like, let's go get this touchdown.
Mike White with a big gamble here on 4th and 5. A field goal would give Albany State a 7-point lead, but White sending a signal to his team that he won 7.
And I would believe that Keyshawn Flakes, when this play is over, is going to have the football in his hands when the officials blow the whistle.
Flakes out of the shotgun. Drops straight back. Was thinking about going left, but Sterling, you are correct. flicks in from five, touchdown Rams.
And just in case you were wondering why the NFL Network pays Fran Charles the big bucks, it's because he lets me hang along with him.
Is that right?
I mean, that's one of those calls that when you have a quarterback that athletic, that understands the game as well as Keyshawn Flakes does, what you do is you want the football in his hands as much, as often, and for as long as possible.
Flakes does a tremendous job seeing the field.
Yes, sir.
And a gutty call by Mike White to go for it. Torrey Torstensen adds the extra point. And what could have been a 7-point lead is now 11. Albany State looking for its sixth straight victory here in the Fountain City Classic. Who's going to the playoffs? Much more when we come back. Albany State's marching band enjoying what it's seeing. They're up 20-10. Actually, Torrey Torstensen missed the extra point, so it's a 10-point lead for the Golden Rams. And Mike White with the gutsy call on 4th and 5. Keyshawn Flakes taking it in for a touchdown.
Did you say gutsy call? I got a guard that's
4th and 5, though.
Sterling. I got a guard that's 385 pounds. Yes, I got a guard that's 340. I got a tackle that's 340. You say gutsy?
Those big boys. They are big boys, yes.
I would never kick on 4th and 5. I would always do that.
Mowing down the field there. It's a great 13-play drive. 66 yards, 7 minutes and 27 seconds. Diggs deep in his own territory. Diggs getting it done out across the 35, 26-yard return. And right now we're actually in the shadows here in Columbus of Fort Benning, where Fort Valley State practiced yesterday. It's home to one of the largest basic training facilities in America, supporting over 100,000 military family members, retirees, civilian employees. Home to the U.S. Army Infantry School, established in 1918. Some great movies were filmed here as well. The Green Beret starring John Wayne in 1966. Black Hawk Down in 2000. Josh Hartnett, Fort Benning. We appreciate, obviously, the great efforts from the people at Fort Benning. It's Williams keeping it himself after the play action.
That was almost a mystery because the fullback almost took the football. I mean, he had to be very strong because Pierre Brown almost took the football. Garrett's reading the backside in. If he crashes down, he's going to pull it. And Pierre almost keeps this football.
Mm-hmm.
And number 42 did an outstanding job right there, staying home. Marjorie McNeil did a good job staying home, making this a 7-yard gain because this almost could have been to the house.
Second down now for the Wildcats as they approach midfield. Williams in the shotgun. And Williams drops straight back and fires it out of bounds.
Well, they had a hitch on, and the corner rolled up on him and man-to-man, and actually you should fly it. So the receiver should have just, you know, put his hand up and kept going down the sideline, but the receiver was indecisive. His indecision forced Garrett Williams' indecision, and we got ourselves an incomplete pass. That's how important it is, throwing the football, how we have to be on the same page.
And there you saw Williams telling Randall right away, get downfield.
Yeah.
Like you mentioned. The Wildcats 7-12 now on third down. This is a short 3rd and 3. They got trips left, and it's Williams on that option play again. This time he hands it to Pierre, and Pierre Brown with 11 yards down to the 42.
So if you get out of bed with speed, there's a good chance you can play college football because all this is speed, because he outruns pursuit to get to the corner and then he stops on a dime and allows that pursuit to run by him and picks up the first down, because right here he doesn't have it. Now watch this. Stays on his feet. That's where he picked up the first down. Gain of 11. Keep the change moving.
He ran past Mordrish McNeil and Brian Richardson. Mario Fuller finally was able to wrap him up. Wildcats inside the Rams territory. 1st and 10 at the 42. Swing pass to Brown. Brown hit hard and dropped. by number 21, Mario Fuller. Fuller came into this game leading this team with tackles, and he's showing us why. Has 61 on the season coming in. He has 5 today.
I think Brown made this tackle. I think Mario Fuller just showed up, and he got tackled because Brown got to him so fast. It was like, oh. But he got him on the ground, which is what you're supposed to do as a defensive guy. Get your guy on the ground, so he did that.
Tell you what, we are seeing some hard-hitting action here.
There's some whacking going on, friend.
Fountain City Classic.
Let me strap my headset on a little more, because, boy, they're hitting out there.
3 yards on the screen, 2nd and 7. And the play clock getting down to 0. But was Williams able to get a timeout call? Yes, he was. So the Wildcats take their first timeout of the second half. As they want to talk over a 2nd and 7. DeAndre Clark, who we talked about at the top of the show, wasn't quite sure what he had at the running back position, and then he found something in Pierre Brown.
It's going to be very important. I mean, even if we're going to do decoys with him with the play action, him being a key to our offense. We found our niche, and running the ball is our niche. And I'm sure Albany State's going to line up trying to stop them. And we're going to play some games and use them as decoys and try to outcoach some people.
And they've done a real good job of that. They've done a good job of, you just saw the old Texas spread option where you fake it to Pierre going one way, the quarterback pulls it out the back door a la Vince Young in Texas. They're using Pierre Brown very, very well. And he was starting to assert himself there at the end of the first half. And now you got a little more balance with them throwing the football. But I like what they have in Pierre Brown. 13 carries, which I think is a little low for a guy coming off a 200-yard game last week. But I believe that the way that the game is setting itself up, he's exactly on schedule to where you would want him to be.
And Brown is also a track All-American. DeAndre Clark telling us yesterday in practice, the guy was too fast and not to eventually get into some action here and get going. Williams on the fake screen, going up top to Randall, who's all alone. Touchdown, Fort Valley State, a 39-yard hookup from Garrett Williams to Nate Randall.
Okay, now we just ran the hitch where the two guys weren't on the same page. They come right back to the same play, and he runs right by the corner. And the football was almost underthrown because he got open so fast. I mean, Nathan Randall ran by him so fast, the football was almost underthrown. But as you look right there, looking in the backfield, very nice catch, very nice throw. Back in this football, friend, we got ourselves a football
game.
We
most certainly do. Big touchdown pass from Williams to Randall. It's their second hookup on the day. Jake Grubbs on for the extra point, and it's good. So Fort Valley State creeps to within 3 of Albany State. O'Brien Russell got beat on the play, almost was able to strip the ball out of Randall's hands, but Randall was able to hold on. And now you see Williams, the leadership role, telling his club, great job, keep it up.
That's what they needed to get back in this football game, and they needed a big play from their offense. It's been there, but the quarterback has been under some duress, hadn't been able to set his feet and throw it through a beautiful pass right there for the touchdown.
Now we're going to try to talk to Wildcats head coach DeAndre Clark. Coach, can you hear us, sir, up here in the booth? DeAndre, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. You're on live with this, coach. Talk to me about that touchdown and what you guys talked about at that timeout.
Well, at some time, the head coach has to make a decision. We've been wide open on the backside the whole time. So we say fake the slip screen that we just ran, and then we're going to throw it deep. I thought my man had hung it up there long enough for him to get an interception, but we still in this thing, and we're going to fight for this next 15 minutes.
All right, coach, thank you very much.
All right, so Jake Grubbs kicking off deep. And for the Golden Rams, it's the battering ram, Demetrius Johnson, 14 yards there. And so that's where the Rams will set up shop at their own 29.
Wow.
DeAndre Clark always with a little bit of a humble pie is what they say for Bill Belichick and the New England Patriots. He thought Williams hung it up there long enough to throw an interception.
I did too. So he and I definitely are seeing the same football game. But the guy's popped so wide open so fast that the quarterback didn't have a chance to come off the pump fake, reset his feet, and to get it out in front.
Right, five plays and 60 yards on that drive for the Wildcats. Flakes looking for some room on the right side. Nothing there. Up. Brought down by Ivan Diggs.
Coach is trying to drive the tempo of this football game way down because Fort Valley looked unstoppable on that last drive. So he's trying to take a little time off the clock. Still got a three-point lead. Now let's take some time off the clock, see if we can't get some field position back.
57 seconds left in the third quarter. The officials huddling up.
Our game clock hasn't been working properly all day.
Game clock to 54 seconds.
I mean, we had a first quarter, the game clock didn't stop. And now we got a third quarter that we can't get it started. So we've had some problems with our game clock.
So Rod Holloway, the referee, asking. Asking for the game clock to be reset. It is showing 1 minute and 1 second.
And he wants it reset to 54 seconds.
Which is what you see on our screen there.
Because we've had problems with the clock, the officials are keeping the official score on the field as well.
No gain for Flakes on that play. Second down and 10 for the Rams. Trips left. Porter in the backfield, and it's Porter on the right side. And nothing doing there as well. Narada Williams with the tackle for the 6-yard loss.
You can give it to Narada Williams, and I'll let you. But the guy who's around the football all day, all the time, Ivan Diggs is just, you know what? Fort Valley should make him a running back and get it over with.
Well, and Dedrick Dodge told us yesterday that he thinks he can play on Sundays.
I agree.
If
you get in the right system.
Right.
And the right system is, he's like a Troy Polamalu, a Ed Reed of the Baltimore Ravens. He's an at-the-line free safety in a 3-4 defense. And he's putting on a show right now. I was going to give the most valuable trophy to a quarterback, but I may have to rethink this.
A big third down here for the Rams. Third and 16. And the play clock ticking down. It's the end of the third quarter, actually. So we got a game here in Columbus, here at Memorial Stadium. 20-17, the Rams are up, but the momentum may have swung to the Fort Valley State Wildcats.
Sure.
Welcome back to Columbus, Georgia. And there you see the Chattahoochee River, which separates Georgia from Alabama.
We had a friend of mine, Sarah Maul, took a wrong turn, ended up in Alabama in a totally different time zone. I mean, that's just how quickly it can happen, friend. One wrong turn, then you're in Central Time.
And there you see how packed the stadium is, the parking lot packed, and you get a great view of this standing room only crowd. Big third down now for the Albany State Golden Rams, third and 16. And they've converted on third down just twice. Flakes looking under pressure, but he steps up and decides to throw, and it's a big completion to Ronnie Child.
Oh, he dropped it. He
fumbled the football.
He dropped the football.
Childs had the first down, but he fumbled the football, and Fort Valley State has recovered.
It don't tell me that number 7, Ivan Diggs, is around this football. Don't tell me that.
It's actually Eddie Young who comes up with it.
Don't tell me that number 7 is around the football.
What a turning point for the Rams, because it was an 8-yard, 10-yard gain. Childs was there, but Rashad Smith with the hit.
Six. Okay.
With the forced fumble, and Young scoops it up.
Fort Valley got exactly what they needed at the right time. And now it's back on their outstanding offense, led by their quarterback, Garrett Williams. Put this football in the end zone.
So Williams, ready to go to work. First and 10 for the Wildcats at their 39. Brown, the lone back. Williams, looking deep downfield, dumps it off to Jarrell Hall, the tight end. There's a flag on the play. Hall now down, dives into the end zone.
He stepped out of bounds. He stepped out of bounds.
He stepped out of bounds for the 13, but there was a flag on the play on the near side of the football field. away from the action, so let's wait and see. Rod Holloway ready to let us know. They're not moving back, so.
Ineligible receiver, number 86 on the offense, down the field. He was covered up at the time of the snap. 5-5 penalty, replay, first down.
What he means by that is the tight end is on the line of scrimmage. You cannot have another receiver on the line of scrimmage outside of him. That would make him ineligible, and that's probably, and that's what happened. I mean, great play design coming out of that turnover, getting a really good block from his wide receiver, steps out of bounds right there, but able to create field position, great play call. I wouldn't be surprised to see that same play in this drive again.
Well, the wide receiver who was outside of Jarrell Hall was number 83, Melvin Atuye. So no fault of Hall's. He did what he was supposed
to do. Yes, he did. I mean, the receiver's got to line up and know that I got a tight end on my side, which makes me the flanker. I got to get off the line of scrimmage. So they had like a double slot look like they have right now, and they both seem to be okay now.
That's the big play comes back, and it's now first and 15. Williams with the pump fake, and he throws a dart to Randall, who's already had a big game with a couple of touchdown receptions. It's 10 yards there, so it'll be second and 5.
And I mean, that's what you have to do. And I'm telling you, I keep talking, singing the praises of these two quarterbacks. Going to talk about Garrett Williams right now, but you don't have to get it all in one play. He goes back, sets his feet, knows what he wants, like what he sees, throws a strike, gives his receiver an opportunity to catch it, protect himself, and have yards after the catch.
And that's what Clark told us was their problem early on when they started out 3-2, that they were always going for the big play and that they dialed it back and started taking what was underneath. They've won 5 in a row. Look at for their 6th straight here. Williams looking again, dumps it off again. This time to Hall, and Hall should have enough for the first down.
Patience and poise. Those are two things that if you mention those two about any quarterback, you got a quarterback that can play at any level. Patience and poise. Patience in the pocket. Now watch the poise. Give his tight end a ball you can catch. You don't know how hard that is, Fran, because that football comes out of nowhere because you got defensive linemen and you got offensive linemen right in front of you, and then the ball shows up. So very good location of the football. You can't throw it as hard because guys on the inside, the tight end right there, doesn't have a lot of opportunity to see it, but he made an outstanding catch. First down, keep the change.
Garrett Williams, 14 of 24, 160 yards and 2 touchdowns. First and 10 at the 26 to Nate Randall again. Randall brought down immediately by Terry McGee, and McGee's slow to get up. It's another first down for the Wildcats, 15 yards on the play.
Wow, they found something, and that is allowing Garrett to go back and throw the football. And Garrett Williams, that's tight. Oh, that's a tight throw right there. And I mean, if the wide receiver can just take another step, catch it in his hands, got an opportunity to break that tackle for a touchdown.
And Randall, 6'2", McGee, 5'10". Williams to Randall for their 3rd touchdown of the game.
That's stealing.
And Fort Valley State leads.
That's stealing.
23-20.
That's stealing, Fran Charles. That's stealing. That is stealing because I'm going to tell you, Nathan Randall is dead tired. He runs this route with absolutely no speed whatsoever and finds the void in the defense and sets it down in a hole between the corner and the safety. Safety got a bad jump, but there is no speed whatsoever in that route. But a great location of the throw, protecting his wide receiver. Oh, my. Oh, my.
Jake Grubbs comes on and tacks on the extra point. The Wildcats getting their first lead of the game. Williams to Randall. The 3rd time, definitely the charm. Fort Valley State up 24-20. Fans starting to get into the brawl for it all. The showdown before sundown. Fort Valley State taking its first lead here at A.J. McClung Memorial Stadium, 24-20. Garrett Williams to Nate Randall. It was a 4-play drive for 39 yards in just 2 minutes and 9 seconds. William Sterling came into this ballgame with 7 touchdown passes. He already has 3. Johnson.
Can't
handle the kickoff, and he is wrapped up. And there is a flag on the play, and now, the Wildcats fired up.
Is this 5 or 15? Because it was grasping of the face mask. I thought the last one was a 15. Which one is this one? Oh, it's accidental.
Still grabbing of the face mask. 3 on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty. Down.
Accidental, friend. I think that from now on, if you get an incidental face mask, you should also be forced to apologize to the guy's face mask you grab. You'd be like, hey, man, that's my bad. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that.
Well, Phillip Smith needing to apologize there. A flag for the incidental face mask. So it helps out the Rams a bit. Still, though, deep in their own territory. First and 10 now at the 10-yard line.
And you got 11 guys inside of 5 yards from the football. I wonder what's coming.
Well, this is what they do best. They average over 217 yards rushing per contest. They need it to get themselves out of a hole here. Flakes on the play at the line, first and 10 at the Rams 10. And Porter and Flakes run into each other, and Porter is down at the 5 for a 5-yard loss.
Well, if he hadn't run into Flakes, he was going to run into Sergio Pinkall anyway, because he was standing in the backfield at the mesh point between the quarterback and the running back anyway. I mean, I just said there's 5 guys within 11, there's 11 guys within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. They're coming, people. When you get that many people at the line of scrimmage in gaps, oh, the blitz is coming. They're not faking it at all. And Fort Valley State is bringing the heat.
Second down and 15. Rams pinned back deep in their own territory at the 5.
12 guys.
Time out.
12 guys in the huddle. Fort Valley had them.
Fort Valley.
They had 12 guys in the huddle.
Second half.
Fort Valley State needs its second timeout in the second half. The momentum has swung towards the Wildcats. They're up 24-20. Much more when we come back.
LT and the boys are playing again tonight. There are no refs, just time.
It's a rivalry that goes back 61 years. Fort Valley State with the edge. They've won this event 31 times, but since they dubbed it the Fountain City Classic, it's been all Albany State. Albany State looking to win this thing for the 6th straight time. But they're in trouble now. Flakes now on a 2nd and 15, and he underthrows Johnson.
And it's easy to see why, because they, for whatever reason, they found a way to get pressure in Keyshawn Flake's face. And they're able to do that with pressure at the line of scrimmage. You got a bunch of guys jumping around and at the line of scrimmage, and all of a sudden now it's harder and harder to find open guys because you're having to throw over somebody else.
Big play for the Albany State Golden Rams. 3rd and 15. They've watched the Wildcats score 14 unanswered points and their 10-point lead disappear. Flakes over the middle. Hits Lamontre Williams, cutting across, and Williams has more than enough for a first down out to the 26 before he's brought out of bounds by Steven Bostic. It's a 26-yard gain and a big play. Check out a 20-yard gain.
Very nice play call. Get a crossing route, pop, clear out the outside, and this is coming into your living room, folks. There's number 5, does an outstanding job catching it in his hands. Lamontre Williams breaks one tackle and then tries to get the football up the field. Outstanding play call versus all that pressure that they've been seeing in the second half.
Big play for Flakes and the Golden Rams offense. And now the officials conferring, calling a quick timeout as Williams gets his equipment straightened out there. His latch on the shoulder pads coming off. How about the poise of Keyshawn Flakes there?
Standing in your own end zone, having to make that throw, better man than me. Under the pressure that he's been under all day, better man than me. I mean, I'm really impressed with these two quarterbacks. They have definitely shown me how the quarterback position in historical black football can be played and is being played.
Place to Williams, 21 yards. Porter stacked up in the backfield. You all right there, Sterling?
Brett McCullum. Excuse me. Brett McCullum just knocked the wind out of me. I'm up here in the booth. Watch this guy feel. I mean, you got to lead it. Just shows up. I mean, that sudden hitting ability, he just shows up all of a sudden, and you know what? You got a loss of 2 yards.
Yeah, and your guy Diggs showed up to clean up the mess here. Second and 12. And Flakes finds Joshua Johnson, who breaks a couple of tackles. It looked like the Wildcats jump. It didn't matter. Check that, Ronnie Childs on the completion, 23 yards.
Wow, they're getting plays in chunks now, and that's what you don't want to see.
Offside, number 91 on the defense. That penalty is declined. Results of the play, first down.
Sergio Pangal jumping off sides, but obviously the Rams will decline the penalty after the big pickup.
20-yard pass completion, 26-yard pass completion. Wow, you can't keep giving up these 20-plus yard catches. You can't do that and get off the field. I mean, they had them backed up and gave up a 20-yard completion.
Remember, this drive, it started at the 10. There was a mishap, went back to the 5-yard line. And now Flakes and company trying to keep it going. Wrapped up by McCullough after a 4-yard gain. Call it 5. Ah, the spot, they just moved it back. All right, let's call it 4.
4.5-yard gain there, friend. 4.5.
Yeah. 10 minutes left to go here in the Fountain City Classic. Albany State trying to recapture the lead. The crowd getting into it. 24-20. The Wildcats are up. Here's a 2nd and 6. And it's a nice stutter step by Porter. And finds 5 tough yards up the middle.
But keeping the offense on schedule now. Now they're in 3rd and 1 or 2 yards to go for a first down. And you can bet your bottom dollar that Albany State, I don't think their kicker is coming on the field unless it's for an extra point.
Starting to get the sense that the team who has the ball last will probably have the best opportunity to win this football game.
You're exactly right.
Flakes directing traffic at the line.
Look where everybody is at the line. The defense looks like they're coming once again.
Gives it to the fullback. Johnson, he makes a nice move and cuts it back to the left side before he's wrapped up by Ivan Diggs.
I mean, the fullback has killed Fort Valley State when they run the football versus a blitz. And all this is, watch the patience. Patience, bounce, skip, bounce. Now go ahead and finish the run. And I mean, that's what they've been able to do. Usually they, early in the first half, they were getting the fullback up the middle, popping him for those first down runs. Now, little patience, little bounce, find it all the way out the back door. First down change moving.
And Murata Williams had a chance to wrap up Johnson, but he couldn't quite do it. Diggs brought him down for a 6th tackle of the game. 1st and 10 up to 37. It's Porter. And there's a flag on the play.
I'm sorry, but number 7, Ivan Diggs, is a football playing dude. Because he not only gets blocked in the hole, he gets cut. He gets up and still gets a piece of the running back. That's a football playing dude, number 7, Ivan Diggs. I think he can play for me any day and twice on Sunday.
Holding, 71 on the offense, 10-yard penalty, down.
I've seen some impressive performances. I've been around football for about 6-8 years now, friend. So I've seen some impressive performances. I am extremely impressed with Ivan Diggs. I mean, outside linebacker, he's a little undersized for an outside linebacker at 210, but he believes in contact. And wherever the contact is, that's where you'll find him.
Well, Diggs shows the intangibles that you can't really teach. And there you see number 98, Princeton Dean, jumping offsides. Play whistled dead. Chris Chapman on the prior play called for holding.
You're standing over the ball. It's right in front of you.
Offside, 98, unabated to the quarterback. Offside, 98, unabated to the quarterback. 5-yard penalty, replay first down.
Dude, you are standing, Princeton. Dude's name's Princeton, so you're over the football. Just look at it. Don't. Just look at the football. You can't go anywhere until the ball moves. And that's what coach is telling them. Hey, we put you over the ball for a reason. Just look at it.
So the Rams get 5 yards back. It's a first and 15 at the 42-yard line. Flakes now trying to draw him offsides. As the play clock ticks down to three. They get it off. Flakes going up top. Young on the coverage looking for Ronnie Childs. Threw it up. But it was incomplete.
Technically, I mean, when I'm talking technique, football friend, when the ball's thrown over the top, I have not seen a ball play better, high school, college, or pro. I've seen them all. Than the way Eddie Young is playing these fade routes. Watch him look. Watch him look. Hands come. Watch his head. Replace the wide receiver. He feels. He falls. Receiver's got no chance. I mean, that's a coaching reel. He has done it perfectly twice now. Doing a very good job technique-wise of making sure that ball hits the ground or he gets a chance to intercept it.
10th play of the Rams drive here, second and 15 at the 42, and now it looks like the Rams with a legal motion.
As long as it wasn't the center move. Part,
number five on the offense. Second down.
I'm okay with number five moving. I'm all right with that. With Lamontre Williams, I'm okay with him moving. If the center had a false start, I was leaving the booth, friend. Because now we got two guys that jump offside standing over the football. I was getting ready to leave, so I'm glad it wasn't the center.
Well, thank goodness Mr. Presley didn't move, because then I would be upset that you would be leaving, because I need you right here. Second and 20 now for the Rams. Flakes. The rush is coming. He dumps it off the quarter out of the backfield. Rashad Smith loses his helmet, but he doesn't lose a grip on Porter, forces him out of bounds after a 6-yard gain. So we got a big third down coming up here. It'll be the 12th play of the drive for the Albany State Golden Rams.
Watch the technique. Where's his head? Tries to get his head across the bow, which is technically sound. Wraps him up, gets the guy out of bounds. Historically, by college football, people talk about the athleticism and the undiscipline of the football that they play. These are two of the most disciplined football teams that I've seen in college football this year.
3rd and 12 on a trips right. It's Flakes to Lamontre Williams. Williams down inside the five, dragged out of bounds by Ivan Diggs at the 6-yard line for a 33-yard gain.
And they figured out, Fran, with the pressure in the middle, get it outside by the numbers. They've come up with three big pass plays on this drive, throwing the football laterally outside by the numbers. And there you go again. Outside the numbers, get it in your playmaker's hands, give him an opportunity to make a play, which is what he did. My man Ivan Diggs tracks him down.
First and goal for the Golden Rams. This drive was all the way back at their 5-yard line. Johnson stacked up at the line. He may have lost one. No gain.
Wow.
Chris Riddle's coming up with the noise.
Boy, did he ever. I mean, it was meeting in the hole, and the defense won that one. I mean, defense definitely won that one, because it's one-on-one, guy standing in the hole, and he stops the running back for no gain. That's impressive.
Second and goal for the Rams, just under 7 minutes left in the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. The winner goes on to the Division II playoffs. The loser goes home. And there is a timeout on the field.
Timeout. Fort Valley.
So Fort Valley using its third and final timeout here. Be interesting to see if that comes back to haunt them. Big finish coming back in the Fountain City Classic after this. The Marching Blue Machine Band from Fort Valley State asking its defense for a big stand here. Second and goal, the Rams driving, looking to take the lead here at the Fountain City Classic. And remember, Fort Valley State out of timeouts. Flakes on a bullet, but he can't connect with Nick Kiles.
Well, I know I'd have the ball in number 11's hands, so I'm in two down territory. I have no need to panic. If I'm Albany State, I can get any kind of run maybe try and get that option and outflank the defense right now and try and get them out of the gate. But I got time. But it looked like they're coming in with the two big guys, so they may try and power this thing in.
Lorani Davis, 6 touchdowns on the season. He has 1 here today, as does Porter.
And Demetrius Johnson, I mean, they've gone heavy. So this looks like it's going to be a power run, mano-a-mano. Two-down territory.
Well, and like you mentioned, you got 2 down, so you might as well jam it up in there. And here is Johnson, the big fella.
Inside the 5. Down to the 2-yard line for a pickup of 3.
I'm putting it in my quarterback's hand. Fran, my quarterback has gotten me here. So Keyshawn Flakes, guess what? You're going to have the football in your hands, and we run. It's going to be run-pass option.
So here we go, crowd. Trying to get both sides fired up.
I'm telling you, the speed option out flanking the defense, that's been a really good play for them. I mean, I like some type of option here to get these guys, get the speed on the corner.
We have seen no shortage of big plays made here in the Fountain City Classic. Just under 6 minutes left. Albany State now using its first timeout in the second half. And let's go back to that. We have seen some real poise in this game.
Yes, yes. I'm telling you. You know, usually when you talk about black college football, historical black college football, you think athleticism, undisciplined. They've been very disciplined, other than the guys lining up offsides, standing over the football. But the quarterbacks have been fantastic today, not only being decisive with the football, but what they want to do with the football. I'm standing here in awe of the show that I've got a chance to witness today, because we've seen 2 very good football teams play very good football.
DeAndre Clark was very jovial with us earlier in the week, but it is all business when it comes to the Fountain City Classic.
Huge. I mean, if it's such a game that people remind you 365 days out of the year of the one that you have to win, I don't think it gets any bigger, sir.
And I mean, definitely any bigger than this game, because we talked about recruiting. We talked about the playoffs, the opportunity to get the kids you want to come and help your program be successful. We talked about the playoff implications that this game has. So, yeah, it's huge. And not only that, you know, sometimes you only have to win 3 games to have job security, and this is one of those 3 that you have to win.
5:53 remaining here in the fourth quarter. This is a huge play. 4th and goal at the 2-yard line. Flakes out of the shotgun. It's Porter in motion. And Flex is going to fire to the end zone to his tight end, Larry Johnson, for the 2-yard score. And Albany State back on top, looking to make it a 3-point lead with 5:50 left.
I'm going to tell you how cute this play was. In the Monday night game with Green Bay and Denver, that play was run by Green Bay and Denver for a touchdown. All it is your tight end blocks, spins around in the end zone. Nobody accounts for him because they think he's blocking. Great play call right there by Donald Pittman, the offensive coordinator for Albany State. Great play design, right time to call it, and outstanding execution for the touchdown.
Troy Torstenson on for the extra point, and he misses another one. Hits the upright and does not go in. And so Albany State up 26-24.
It is a very cute play, because he blocks and then he spins around in the end zone, and all you got to do is get it to him. And Keyshawn Flakes does. 26-24, Albany State.
Welcome back to the Seesaw Affair here. Albany State going back on top 26-24. A 15-play drive for 90 yards. Keep in mind, on the first play, they lost 5 yards, so they went 95 yards. And what balance, Sterling? 8 passes and 7 rushes.
Yo, I mean, great balance, great offensive design. And how about the players executing that game plan to perfection? And, I mean, that's what you got to have in a game of this magnitude. You need your stars to step up, and the stars shined very bright on that last drive, led by Keyshawn Flakes.
Patrick Cuff set to kick away, digs and cuts deep for the Wildcats. It's a short kick. Diggs picks it up at his 19-yard line, out across the 35 to the 38 for a 17-yard game. This game could come down to the field goal kickers. Jake Grubbs has been the man for DeAndre Clark's Wildcats all season long.
He's always important, and we have to let him know that he's important, you know, because between quarterbacks and kickers, their mindset, you have to kind of let them know how special they are. So he is the epitome of special to us because he's brought us through. I mean, he's been consistent, and he knows that kicking is a good thing for us.
And you talk about a good thing. I mean, having the ability to know that your guy can deliver, already has delivered from 42 yards. Be patient, take your time, and just work your way down the field. The time is on your side, even though you don't have any timeouts left.
Empty backfield there. Tennyson couldn't hold on. Getting back to Grubbs, he leads the SIAC conference, knocking down 13 out of 18 field goals. And he's won three games for him this year.
And that's big. Oh, that's big. And in a game of this magnitude, you got to have somebody that is as close to automatic as you can have in this conference. You need that on your football team.
And what do they call him, Sterling?
Sugarfoot.
Second down.
Sugar.
And 10 for the Wildcats, 5:41 left. They fake the screen, and then Williams goes up top to Randall, but he can't hold on at the last minute.
And you know what? I'm not going to put that on Randall on that throw. I'm going to put that on the location of the football. That's two straight throws from Garrett Williams. The location has been off. That way the ball falls incomplete. If he throws it across the field because there's no free safety, he's got himself a touchdown. But he throws it back over the back shoulder of the receiver going on a post route. A very tough adjustment. That's why you have an incomplete pass. Huge third down. But remember, they're in two down territory as well.
You think so? 5:34 left.
Oh, yeah.
Down territory.
Oh, yeah.
5:34. This is a third and 10. They've converted 8 out of 13 third down conversions and make it 9 out of 14. Randall with the catch. It'll be close,
oh,
but I think he got
spot.
Enough for a first down.
That's a bad spot. He was just upside the 5 on the 50-yard line when he caught that football. I thought he had it by a good 2 yards, but it's a first down, so to keep the chains moving.
Randall with his sixth catch of the game. They're
look
giving him
that.
The first down.
Look at that
They're
throw.
Moving the chains.
Look at that throw over the top in the face of pressure. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, we've seen very good quarterback play here this afternoon. Outstanding quarterback play. These two leaders of their two respective football teams.
Randall with 6 catches. 3 of them are for touchdowns. First and 10 at the 48. Williams now decides to see if he can get out of pocket, but he's wrapped up by Derek Battle for the sack.
Defense won that one. They did a very good job in coverage, forced the quarterback to hang on to the football and bail to his left, and there's nowhere for him to go. I mean, what can you do? You go back to pass, and you hope you can get it out of your hands in rhythm. You're not able to get it out of your hands in rhythm, which means you're either going to have to make a play with your legs or sometimes the defense is going to win, though.
4:40 remaining and counting here in the fourth quarter. And remember, the Wildcats have burned up all their timeouts. It's 2nd and 17. 16. Williams now looking. Pass time. And he lets it fly. He's got a wide open Darius Williams. Williams inside the 20, down to the 15 before he's brought down by Mario Fuller for 44 yards.
I can't tell you how special this quarterback play we're watching is, because he is about to make a monumental mistake and move, and he stops at the right second and finds a wide open receiver down the left sideline. Watch the poise in the pocket. Now watch him stop, set his feet. Look at this strike. That's tight, folks. That's tight. Catch it. Great location. Protect yourself. Yards after the catch. Man, the quarterback play here is going to make me want to come back and play college football.
Clock running now inside of 4 minutes. 3:53 and counting. First and 10. Inside the 20. And it's Brown. Check that. Chris Watson.
And Chris Watson missed the hole. He was trying to get that football outside. If he turns it up 4 steps earlier, I think he's still running, because everybody was tracked to the sideline, was blocked to the sideline. He had a great opportunity to just slide it up inside and go for more yardage. He missed the hole on that one.
And we are under 3 minutes and 20 seconds. And in case you're wondering, Jake Grubbs' career-long field goal, 46 yards. So they are well within Grubbs' range here. The Wildcats trying to snap a 5-game losing streak to Albany State.
I'm wondering where Pierre Brown is and why isn't he in this football game right now, because this is his time.
Williams hands it off.
to Watson.
I mean, Pierre Brown has got to be hurt because this is his time and he should be in this football game.
Interesting play call there, Sterling, on second and long, too.
I mean, I you know, I'm all about going for the, I mean, the way your quarterback is playing, I'm definitely putting the football in his hands. But now we've had two runs from a guy that I didn't even know was on the depth chart until I looked down. So Pierre Brown has got to be nicked up not to be in this lineup at this stage of the football game.
2:20 and counting here in the fourth and final quarter. It's a big play for the Wildcats, 3rd and 13. Williams on the pump fake, but he throws behind Nate Randall. Stops the clock with 2:13 left. And here comes
Sugar. Sugar coming into the game to try and give Fort Valley a one-point lead. I agree with you on the play calling here because I would have done that play two plays ago on first down. Sugar.
His career long is 46 yards. Jake Bruggs trying to knock his second field goal down of the game from 41. He's ready. Snap down. Kick is up. And it's right through the upright.
Sugar! Oh, Sugar doing it for us, baby. That's what I'm talking about. If you got a nickname, if you got the nickname Sugar, you better be sweet, and sweet he was on that kick right there.
Jake Grubbs with his 14th field goal of the season. It leads the conference, and it gives Fort Valley State a one-point lead with 2:06 left in the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. And it certainly had the distance. He drew it in there like you do with your 9-iron.
Oh, man, I'm telling you. He was hitting a nice high draw. And all the kicks we watched yesterday in their walkthrough, everything was a nice high draw. So they did a good job getting the ball on the right hash mark, giving him the angle to hit the draw. And I'm telling you, from what I've seen today, if this holds up and Fort Valley goes on to win this game by one, I'm going to change his nickname from Sugar to Money because that's what he's been for Fort Valley all season long.
All right, drive of 9 plays, 43 yards. Grubbs with a 36-yard field goal, his second of the game. And keep in mind, we mentioned a lot more than bragging rights on the line for both these two teams. The top 6 teams in each region in Division II football advance the playoffs. There are 4 regions. These two teams are in the Southeast region. Fort Valley State sits at 6. Albany State 6 at 9. The winner is in. The loser goes home. Johnson now at his own 6 for the Rams. Needs a good kickoff, but he is hit and hit hard, but he bounces off and spins to the left side. Almost gets out.
He lost to the 30.
21 yards. Sugarfoot is Jake Grubbs. Here is DeAndre Clark on the rest of the nicknames.
You know, to expose some of the guys' nicknames. You know, we got names ranging from Hardhead to Baby Hands to Sugarfoot to Hoss. Guys earn nicknames for various reasons and things like that. But I wouldn't expose who the nicknames belong to keep from embarrassing them. But at the same time, they know who they are. Some of the guys know how they earn those nicknames.
How do you yell at a guy named Sugarfoot?
Miss enough kicks, you know.
Well, Jake Grubbs has not missed any kicks, and it's nothing but smiles and hugs so far.
And you know what? The one thing I learned watching his football team yesterday in their walkthrough, they have great respect for Coach Clark, but they have a lot of fun playing for him as well. So the epitome of a player's coach is a guy you have great respect for, but that you'll run through a wall for, that's Fort Valley. That's what they'll do for Coach Clark.
A 9-yard gain from Flakes to Nick Kyles there. And that time, Robert Taylor can't hold on. The swing pass. Remember, there's 1:44 left, and the Rams have 2 timeouts. Plenty of time.
And we're in 2-down territory. We're always going to be in 2-down territory because Albany State's kicker has proven that, you know what, he's not getting the job done today. So I don't think he's going to get an opportunity unless it push comes to shove to end this football game.
Well, they do have 2, and Torrey Torstensen, who has missed 2 extra points, they use him more in the short field goal situation. They got a guy who they believe can kick longer field goals, Patrick Cuff. He's knocked down 4 of 7. Diggs there to break up the play.
No, Diggs there. Hey, that was a pick six. That was, boy, you talking about a break on the football. He got a jump on the football. Look at this. And he's off to the races. If the receiver doesn't knock him off stride just a little, he is still running, folks.
You mentioned two down territory. Fourth down here, 1:40. Play of the game. Give for it, the Rams.
Give it to the fullback. Your fullback has been money for you all day long. Number 34, Demetrius Johnson. Give him the football.
The Wildcats have 8 in the box. It's Lonnie Davis. And Davis busts free. And Davis in traffic. Gone at the 30, 20, 10, 5. Touchdown, Lonnie Davis, his second of the game. And the Albany State Golden Rams go back on top after a 64-yard gallop from the big fella.
I can't do this anymore. I got nothing left. They've taken every ounce of energy I've had. You got an all-out blitz. They popped the tailback through. Great lead block by the fullback, who I wanted them to give the football to. And it's off to the races by Lonnie Davis. Folks, I can't breathe up here in the booth. I'm hyperventilating. I'm going to have to give myself mouth to mouth. I can't take it.
Davis with his second touchdown of the game. He leads this Rams team with 7 on the year. And he has had a big day. And we talked about it with 1:29 left, Sterling. The team that actually has the ball last might have the best chance to win.
Oh, my God. Friend, when you look at this football game, and there's been some ebbs and flows in this game that have been unbelievable. 4th and 2, you run a lead play, and your guy takes it to the house. Now you're going to are you going for two? You're going to go for two here and try. I mean, look at this. Great bounce, great skate, now finish. And, I mean, the big fella running a straight line, it's hard to catch a big fella running a straight line. Very good blocking at the point of attack. That's what got him in the open.
Can you say Brandon Jacobs?
Very
good. 6'2", 250 pounds.
Very Brandon Jacobs-like on that run. But I'm telling you, I am so impressed with these two football teams and the fight that these two football teams have had today, because there is never any quit. I mean, you talk about no quit, you talk about, man, I'm telling you, I'm about to pass out. I'm so excited.
Rams going for two here to try to make it a 7-point lead. Flags are down everywhere.
Offside defense.
Incomplete.
Guy running on
Cameron
the field
Smith.
Late. Get a chance to get into the defensive set. Get another crack at it. Offside defense.
Minute 29 left.
Offside. 48 on the defense. 48 was on the snap. Half the distance to the goal. Replay.
So that is Jeff Peebles.
Let me
get a quick start.
I've seen a lot of plays, but I like the last lead that went for about 60. I mean, you got it on the 1-yard line. What's wrong with the lead play for one? I mean, it's been good to you. God knows it's been good to you. What a football game.
So the Wildcats the Rams have got a second chance here for a 2-point conversion, and there is movement again. I think this time, though, the offensive line moved.
False start, 7-3 on the off. Kennedy.
Arthur Smith, where are you going? Hey, Art, wait. Hey, Art, you're right next to the ball. You should be able to see it. Where are you going? Wow, maybe you should put blinders on them.
So that is a big penalty because it moves it back 5 yards. So this 2-point conversion now coming from about the 6, almost the 7 with 1:29 left. Albany State trying to push its lead to 7 points up 5. Flakes back trying to make something happen. Flips it out, but they rule it incomplete. He had Porter wide open.
That would have been a heck of a play by the quarterback, because it looked like the speed option out the gate. Tries to throw it, and then he doesn't give up on the option guy. I mean, comes out, looks like the speed option. Now look at the tailback, just drift down the sideline, and man, he gave him a good chance, and that's a tough play for a running back not used to catching the football, because ball in the ground like that, throw your elbows together, let it roll up into your chest and cradle it. But that's an outstanding effort by a quarterback, outstanding effort by a running back trying to get the two-point conversion.
Nevertheless, the Rams are up five after a four-play, 73-yard, a scoring drive, 25 seconds. Lorani Davis, 64 yards on the big gallop. Albany State, 3 of 3 on fourth down today. There is a minute 29 left. Fort Valley State now will get its opportunity. And remember, they have no timeouts left. They burned them all early.
And that's not so big, needing a touchdown, because after the first down, the clock's going to stop. So you just got to think first down.
Patrick Cuff hoping for a deep kick here. Diggs takes it at his 18. And he goes right up the middle. Tries to go up and over, but he's brought down after a 14-yard gain.
Let's take a look at that touchdown one more time, because coming into your living room, watch the point of attack block right there. There's the bounce, there's the cut, and now it's a straight line run by the big fella. And let me tell you, great blocking at the point of attack by those big heavies up front for Albany State. I'm telling you, with an offensive line that size, they should have, could have, and would have been doing that all day long. But they got the big run on fourth down when they needed it. They got the touchdown when they needed it.
Brandon Jacobs had 100 yards for the Giants overseas in London in their first NFL regular season game outside of North America. Lorani Davis doing his best to catch Jacobs, 75 yards for the game. Williams now scrambling, looking, and he throws an interception, but he's ruled out of bounds. Wow. Mordrees McNeil was right there, but he was out of bounds.
Wow. Because I thought he had the crossing route right here. And that's what I thought. I thought he had the crossing route. But, man, you cannot throw that football back in the field of play from right there. You cannot make that mistake.
How close was that? Wow. A minute 13 left here at A.J. McClung Memorial Stadium for the Fountain City Classic. The brawl for it all, living up to the hype. The winner on to the Division II playoffs. Williams now on a 2nd and 10 out of the shotgun. And he rolls out to his left under duress, and he throws it away out of the pocket. The Rams will want a flag for intentional grounding.
It's a situation where a young man is trying to do too much. You're not going to get it in one play. You know they're going to be in zone defense. They're going to be holes. You got to take the 6, 8, 9-yard completion just to keep your offense on schedule. You cannot continue to put yourself in third down situations with a minute and four. You're going to run out of time.
Donald Hannah with the big pressure there on Williams. 3rd and 10, a minute and four remaining in the contest. They certainly will be going for it on fourth down. Low snap, but Williams is there to scoop it up. And he fires, and he finds Williams, who catches it, but is hit and fumbles the football. And the Rams say they've recovered. And the officials concur.
I don't think he caught it, and I don't think they had, it doesn't look like they had it in bounds. I mean, it looked like he was out of bounds when he recovered it.
Big play by the Albany State Golden Rams. Brian Richardson with the recovery. First things first, was it a catch?
I would have to say it's a catch. And then now I want to see the recovery, because, wow, it looked like he was out of bounds. Yeah, it's a catch, because he caught it and made a move. So he definitely had it. And now it's going out of bounds. And, oh,
ooh. Ah, the Rams may have gotten away with one there. Terry McGee forcing the fumble. 53 seconds remain. The Wildcats cannot stop the clock, so Flakes takes a knee.
Oh, my goodness.
I don't know about that one. I don't think Richardson had control of the football before he got out of bounds.
I didn't think so either. Boy, I tell you, but what a football play. Wow. I mean, what a play by Terry McGee. Because I don't think he has control of the football, and he's out of bounds.
Clock ticking down now, 20 seconds left. And keep in mind, there is no replay in the SIAC, so
Wow.
The officials are not going to take another look at that play. Clock down to 10-9. Flakes with the kneel down. And the Albany State Golden Rams, 3-2. They're going to win the 18th annual Fountain City Classic. They win it for the sixth straight time. They lead the series 14-4, and they are moving on to the playoffs.
And I tell you what, I like what they do offensively. I love their quarterback in Keyson. I think he played outstanding football today, Keyson Flakes. But I'm telling you, this football team can run the ball against anyone. And I don't want to play this football team because they're going to beat me up with the size of that offensive line and the size of their big backs. I'm impressed with what Albany State was able to do in winning this football game. But boy, I'm impressed with Fort Valley as well.
What a contest here in Columbus. 32-27, Albany State wins it. So the 18th annual Fountain City Classic in the books. Albany State on the way to the playoffs. We'd like to thank the wonderful people of Columbus, Georgia, and the organizers of the Fountain City Classic for hosting a truly entertaining event. We invite everyone to flip over to NFL Network immediately following the Pats and Colts game for NFL Game Day on Sunday. For Sterling Sharp and our entire NFL Network crew, I'm Fran Charles. Albany State rolls on. They win the Fountain City Classic. Good night from Columbus.